Greetings, everyone, and welcome to a very special insectoid, is that a word?
No.
Episode of Monster Party.
Monster Party.
Monster Party.
Yeah. I'm sorry, do we have a... That buzzing in the wire came back. Oh, that's Larry.
Yes, it's
oh,
me
doing an insect sound.
Yes, insect sound.
An insectoid.
And why is he doing that sound?
Well, it's because I'm so excited. And who are you?
I am Matt Weinhold.
I am Shawn Sheridan.
I'm Larry Strothe.
And I'm James GONIS.
And this episode... Oh, my goodness, the topic.
Put now, the swatters away.
Well, here we go. Now, you guys know, we all love bugs.
Bugs.
But what's our pet peeve? They're just not goddamn big enough.
Right.
And so, for this episode...
This episode!
The topic is going to be...
Then what is this topic?
Big bugs!
Big bugs! Bugs.
And before we get into
like
armchair entomologists out there, you know, when we say bugs, we just use it as a sort of an overreaching term.
It could
any kind of insect.
Arachnids.
Yes.
Yeah.
Worms. The whole world
the whole
of
bug. The whole creepy crawly.
Yes, creepy crawlers.
The whole bug scene.
Yes.
Love it. You might ask, what possible guests could you get for this episode who would be perfectly perfect.
I was asking that. And I think
We have him, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
He is a writer. He is a director. He did a little stand-up comedy even at one point. So he's kind of one of us when it comes to that. Ladies and gentlemen, he is the director of Big Ass Spider.
Big Ooh. Ass Spider.
And Lavalantula.
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 Ladies and gentlemen, it's Mike Mendez.
Hello, kiddies. Hello. Yes. We're talking this way the whole episode, correct? No.
Wait, are we not?
Is that what is that?
It was kind of a crypt keeper kind of thing,
like
you
it.
Know, with
I
a
like
kind
it.
Of ghoulish
you know,
thing.
I thought it was kind of like it was kind of like a little grasshopper voice. That's what I
it
thought.
It could be a grasshopper thing, you know. He started it, so I was going with it.
We're not doing that.
I love
that,
what
did
he's
I get the, did I get the
I
memo?
Love the fact that he's getting into the feel of
yes.
Monster Party.
Yes, I like it too.
And what you are doing, you're like no, right out of the gate.
No.
The whole podcast
no, my,
was
no,
this way. We're not doing funny
no,
monster voice. Okay.
Well, we will, out of spite.
No. We're not going to do funny
anyway,
voices.
Larry.
No, come on, guys. Because this is big. This is
serious. Don't you understand?
Yes.
Why don't we talk about our first big bug movie?
All right. This is very, very funny. I'm sure our listeners want to get to this. Now, I mean, Mike. Mike's,
all right, everybody
Mike's,
stop having fun.
No. Mike's, he's a director. He's a writer, producer, editor. Yes.
And
yes.
A big monster fan, too, right?
Of course, yes.
Collector.
Love monster movies. Collector, yes. I feel very at home. We are surrounded by just a shitload of geeky stuff.
Yes. Yes, we are.
And I feel very, very comfortable here. So,
awesome. Yes. Nice. Great
we
to
want
have you
to stay.
We can say not naughty words, right? We can.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, hell yeah. Right.
Fuck shit.
Well,
cocksucker.
You know, let's tone it down, you know,
when
as,
it's
as much as we can. You know, when it's, let's not go, hey.
Like that's a big
I
fucking
wasn't,
spider.
doing an Andrew Dice Clay thing here. I'm not just, you know, just busting them out.
No, but
it
Mike,
was, you're, for appropriate.
So your whole life, you've been a big monster fan your whole life.
I think, you know, and it's a question for you guys. I mean, when does kind of the love for the genre and monsters begin? I kind of believe that some of us are born with it.
When did it hit you?
As long as I can remember. I mean, I remember the first toys that I always wanted were the Remco, I believe they're called Monster Party, by the way.
Ooh.
There was a Dracula and werewolf and mummy and Frankenstein.
Were these the glow-in-the-dark ones?
Yes.
They
had glow-in-the-dark versions, but they were very close to the Mego.
Like 8-inch, 6-inch.
Exactly. When you
move
a lever,
the Mego ones that had glow in the dark eyes.
Oh, those
and hands.
Ones.
Yes.
I love those.
Wasn't it Mod? Was it Mod?
It wasn't
the Mad Monsters. Were the
Mad Monsters?
Were
Mad Monsters.
That was the Mego.
I think you're right.
Yes. Yes. We're right.
Yeah. Those
I have them hanging in my bathroom. I'm going to check it out. When I
wait,
go
wait they're hanging in your bathroom?
I do, yes.
They're well, not
they're
on replicas. A shelf behind glass?
They're replicas. I got, like, they made replicas that are carded, and so I have them hanging up. So,
nice. Anyway.
But yeah, no, the love for monsters began. Now, I don't know if my parents were just, like, just awful parents and didn't censor what I watched.
Best kind of parents
that's
ever.
The best
I know,
kind
exactly.
Of parents.
Yes,
yeah.
I agree. But I saw all of the at least for my generation, all the classics, Halloween, I didn't see Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but Nightmare on Elm Street, Friday the 13th, all that stuff I saw.
That was like the Fangoria era.
Chainsaw was kind of a hard one to see. As
yeah,
a kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
The only thing I didn't see in the theater of like kind of my era was like Alien. That's the only one that my family wouldn't take me to. So
yeah.
But everything else I saw. I remember one of my first memories, period, is seeing The Hills Have Eyes when I was three.
That's a favorite over here.
How old were you?
Three.
Oh, my gosh. What?
Literally two of my first memories, and I don't mean memories of movies, just my two memories are the ending of Carrie and in The Hills Have Eyes when they took the canary and crushed it and,
sure,
and drank
yes.
its blood.
Oh, my gosh.
Those are, and it gave me a career.
They drew the line at Alien, but you got to see The Hills Have
it
Eyes.
It was weird. I think it was Rhona Barrett or something like that gave a review of like, you do not take children to see Alien. You know,
you know what I'm wondering, Mike? I'm wondering if your parents took you, but thinking, he's going to fall asleep. He's not going to pay attention. He's not. Your parents wanted to get out. And they thought it was a
Disney movie or something.
Like the Sound of Music.
It's about some mountains with eyes.
God's honest truth, my dad loved movies, as did my brother, and they went to movies all the time. And at that time, it was about $1.50 to bring a kid or something like that. So you're not going to get a babysitter. You're going to bring the kid. Like, he'll be fine. They won't even remember this stuff. It'll be fine.
My mom took me to that movie as a kid.
Which one?
The Hills Have Eyes.
Oh, Hills Have Eyes. Oh, really?
Because it was part of it. This is how I got to see those movies, because there was always like a dumb one that was the first feature or something that was like my mom would go, that's got to be okay. And then The Hills
Have
Eyes.
Like Herbie Goes Bananas.
Right. Exactly. And then like the second one was always just completely inappropriate.
Right.
That's
right.
How I saw like They Came From Within.
Okay. Right, right.
But like The Hills Have Eyes was the second feature. And I remember just watching that and my mom, you know, would look over to me and like, should I take him out of here?
Right.
Like, no, Mom.
The answer was yes, they should have,
And when he eats the bird and sucks the blood out of it, didn't you watch that and just think, so that's how you do that?
Well, I mean, look, as a child, you kind of, you know, even as an adult, you relate to animals and, you know, you love animals and cute things. So it was very impactful. I mean, I can imagine.
It's a scary movie. I think it still holds up.
Yeah, but this is great.
I like the second one with the flashback from the dog. That's right.
And then the third one, The Hills Have Bugs.
Yeah. Because I was going to say, this is great, but I wanted to know, Mike.
Getting to know each other.
I know, but I wanted to know, when did you get into, like, big bugs? Did you have,
big
like,
bugs.
A, yeah, okay. did you, did, what was your first bug movie that you saw or insect thing
it's
that you
very
saw?
Very good question. Growing up here in Los Angeles, I think KTLA Channel 5 showed a lot of that stuff. So so certainly the Godzilla films, I guess Mothra would be kind of my first big bug.
Mm-hmm.
But I also had a love for Empire of the Ants. That was one that they showed a lot. And again, not because they were, like, I seek them out. It's just that was what was ever on syndication.
It was on.
Show.
Right.
Yeah. You know, we had, we were lucky enough, or I was, you know, to have Elvira as a local horror host.
Yes.
So Movie Macabre was.
I remember seeing the first Elvira.
Absolutely, yeah.
I was like, totally. Oh, this is awesome.
Yeah, so I love that. So it was whatever they were showing, which tended to be kind of cheesy or low budget fare.
Right,
you
right.
know, there's not a lot of A-list big bug movies, I don't think. I mean,
well,
you know.
well, in the 50s,
I guess when you go back, them, I think at the time was considered.
Was it at the time? I don't know.
I think it was considered a relatively big movie.
Yeah, okay. It was a Warner Brothers, right? And it was it was probably the first Atomic Age big bug movie, and that ushered in a whole bunch of them from that point.
Some good names in there.
Well, the neat thing about them is, okay, this is from 1954, and it was directed by Gordon Douglas, who actually went on to direct Robin and the Seven Hoods.
Oh,
and also way out with your favorite Jerry Lewis.
That's right.
I think, you know? So imagine.
And then the sequel, Those.
Yeah. No, and this
courtesy of James.
No, and this has James Whitmore, who did a bunch of classic Twilight Zone.
He's a big A-list actor.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a really good movie, especially when you consider...
No, that's a really cool movie.
Yeah, when you consider the fact that those ants... Where they just built those ants and they're on a crane.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. How effective they are.
How cool is that? Actual physical, giant, like practical effects.
It affects you more because it is a physical thing as opposed to if they had done stop motion. It would have been cool.
No, that would have been so
different.
Cool.
It would have been different.
It would have been different, but it would have been cool. Yeah, no. I mean, that's one of the things that I think appealed to me were those large puppets. You know, I also grew up a Muppet fan, so puppetry and all that kind of thing was always appealing to me. I wanted to be a makeup artist when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. So practical effects were always a huge thing. I don't know if this would count as a big bug movie. This is a little controversial, but I would say one of the things that gave me a huge appeal into that was The Thing, you know, because they had lots of... the spider head and the creatures like that.
Oh, Carpenter's
thing. Carpenter's a thing, yes.
Right.
You know, and so I kind of grew an affinity for that and the love of practical effects. I kind of took them hand in hand. So.
You go back and forth with that movie of whether, the head that grows the legs.
Mm-hmm.
Because I go spider. Some people say crab, but I say...
Yeah, that's a spider head.
I say spider.
That's a spider head, 100%.
It's funny you should say that because I'm kind of on that line, Matt. Whether I think crab or spider, I do think it is more spider.
They're more spidery.
They're spidery, even though, again, it's not considered a giant bug movie by any means, but, you know, that if you look at the design, everything is based off like a cockroach and stuff like that.
Totally.
Yeah.
Going back to them for a second, though, that movie, too, what works with that movie is the build-up. It's a long build-up, and it's quite a mystery as to like what's going on, what's causing this damage, what's killing these people, and this was the first big giant bug movie of the time. So it was like there was no precedent really of what this was going to be like. So it was
what's right or what's wrong.
The way they used the sound.
That's a great way to establish. Dread.
Yeah, with the little
hell
girl.
Is that?
Well, it's like
what
it's,
is it that she smells the formaldehyde or something? It's a certain thing they have
like a smelling salt.
Yeah, smelling salt, but it reminds her of that.
Exactly,
and
it's
them.
Film is interesting in the sense that it starts out these cops come up in this desert area and they find this little kid that's just wandering through the desert. Seems to be totally freaked out, kind of in a trance almost. And it's like, oh my gosh, what happened? And I go back to the home to find that it's...
Yeah, she's totally, in shock because her parents are killed.
Yeah, totally destroyed. And they slowly learn about this giant colony of ants.
Yeah.
And can you imagine being one of the guys who gets to operate one of those giant mandible?
At
the time, though, probably not the best job.
I always admire, I see it's not the same because I don't love CG, I'm always a practical guy. Amazing stuff that you can do.
It has
with
its
CG,
time and place.
But there's a guy, I'm seeing this behind the scenes video of Game of Thrones, and there was a guy who gets to be the dragon, and he had just spandex, but he had these wings and this kind of thing, and he gets to like flap it, and I'm like, God, that's a great job.
So like the Andy Serkis of dragons.
He's the guy you call.
Awesome.
I would love to do that. Of course,
right?
Are you saying he's wearing spandex?
Yeah, totally.
Hey. Well,
you're right. It's the perfect job. Finally, it's all come together for you.
I've missed my calling,
It's not too late, man.
No.
Go for your dream.
No, but getting back to them, though, but the scientists, they learned that there's this belief that because of the atomic testing that's within the area, that is what has mutated these ants.
It's like
what you were saying, Sean, about it's one of the first... Like atomic.
Yeah, it's also the quintessential atom age monster movie because, it's one of the first of the, oh my God, it's caused by radiation, it's caused by the atomic bomb, giant bugs. It's kind of like just that iconic kind of idea.
And not to make light of what happened in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but could you imagine the most horrific horror movie? Imagine if you had a city that was, an atomic bomb was dropped on it. That's already horrible. So now you've got this post-apocalyptic nightmare that they're living in. And then you, on top of that, add almost immediately everything is giant bugs, giant everything.
Right.
And if you think about ants, the thing about ants that really gets me is ants can lift like, what was it? Something like 6 or 8 times their weight, or more than that. And so here you have a giant, massive ant.
Sure.
And now, can you imagine he's going up to a Mack truck or something and pushing over a building or something like that?
And
it's not just one or two. It's hundreds of thousands, millions of ants.
Too bad they could only afford 3.
Yeah.
But
for the 3 they had, they did a pretty good job.
Yeah, it was great. That
movie pretty much opened the floodgates for every other kind of like giant insect. That point, I mean, you had tarantula.
I'm hoping we're going to go through some of these.
Yeah,
nice
totally.
I mean,
well, but tarantula would be the next big one, I would think.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Which was not as appealing to me, largely because it was a real tarantula.
Right, I agree. Right. Totally agree.
And it didn't have either a stop motion element or puppets.
You weren't a fan. I agree with that.
It's fine. I mean, I enjoy it, but there's something special about when you have an actual puppet or an actual like creature effect. The fact that it was always, you know, just a actual tarantula crawling was a little like, whatever.
But there was something kind of cool in
they did a good job though, considering.
Yeah,
also,
totally.
It grew. It was a story where it didn't start out giant, but it grew.
And you did have also, for the horror effect, you had Leo G. Carroll, who's getting the acromegaly disease, and the other guy running around with the mutated face.
That was the part that I enjoyed more.
Yeah, because like, so you had other monster elements.
The tarantula was, I thought, the better story.
And, and what's cool is the film actually, so this takes place in 1955, and this is actually directed by Jack Arnold, who brought us, you know, It Came from Outer Space, The Creature from the Black Lagoon, and you have the great John Agar and Mara Corday.
Oh yes, Mara Corday.
But what's cool is the film actually starts out, you know, again out in the desert, and there's this weird figure that is walking. It looks like they're in their pajamas or something, and their face looks kind of corroded or funky, and then drops down.
It looks like a weird caveman.
Yeah, like a caveman.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you're like, what the hell is this? And he drops down to the ground, then da-da, the music. And already, it's not a tarantula. It's some dude, some funky-looking dude.
Because he's experimenting on different things. He got injected or something. It's cool, though. That's why, like you said, there's other cool horror elements to it.
Yeah, what we learn is Leo G. Carroll, he's the scientist who's... And what's cool is he's actually trying to do good.
I saw Leo G. Carroll. No?
No,
Rocky Horror Picture Show?
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry.
Open Channel D?
but anyway, he's a scientist that's trying to figure out a way. Look, if we can inject these creatures into and make them grow, like if you have, let's say, a chicken or a pig, you know, it's like if they grow bigger, oh my gosh, now we have more pork, or a rabbit, now we have more rabbit meat, or a giant pig or a, you know, giant chicken. And the thing that gets me is I don't know why he would have had a spider. Maybe it was kind of like, you know, okay, he's testing the rats.
That's a really good point. Why don't we experiment on the nicest, fluffiest animals we can find?
Yeah, like the bunny rabbit and a little mouse. And I get that. And I guess rats are used a lot in scientific experiments. So that makes sense. Yeah. And I guess maybe he tried to do the spider or the tarantula thinking that, well, I don't know, maybe this will
get loose.
No, Matt. I'm thinking, what about spider meat? Maybe if a spider meat.
I hear spider is not delicious. Yeah. That's from my understanding.
Look.
In Thailand, there's a big market.
Yeah.
Tastes like chicken.
Spider chicken.
Anyway, the guy, he's trying to do good, and then because of the radiation, you know, and the mistakes,
it's always
the
radiation.
And then it's like
the kids and their radiation.
It's like what you said. It gives him this disease.
You ever eaten an insect? It's no good.
Well, hey, yeah. I'm just look.
A cricket isn't bad.
No,
I get it stuck in my teeth, and it's really a gross feeling.
Yeah,
yeah. See, no, like,
do you ever do the fried crickets?
I've done the fried crickets.
Yeah. I've done the ants.
You can't even taste.
Yeah, you can't even tell. They're like on something else.
But anything with an exoskeleton tends to get caught in your teeth as kind of a.
I see.
So
I just
down on the.
Okay,
on the spider
I think
meat.
Of it as like little tiny soft shell crab.
Okay, Mike. Do you eat crab?
I do.
Okay, so imagine if you will, you know, you have a big crab leg or something. You open it up, and there's a meat. Well, what if you had a giant spider, maybe, and it's big and it has big, thick legs or something, and it's just giant? You know, cut the legs and open up the legs. Maybe there's neat spider meat.
If we're experimenting on making animals big according to their deliciousness, we're going in the wrong direction.
We'd have some big chickens.
We're making some leaps here.
That would be a big-ass cow.
Matt, don't get me wrong. I'm just trying to give... What was he thinking? What was his logic?
Well, aren't crabs and spiders like in the same family?
Yeah, they're both arachnids.
Yeah,
so
start with a crab.
Crustacean.
Yeah, but then you need all that water.
Yeah, crustacean. Well,
and then you have like this vat of butter and lemon in case they go out of control. You just drop that on them.
Like a big nutcracker.
Yeah.
You know, I understand where you're going, Mike. You're not necessarily the biggest fan of tarantula. You know, I liked it because just the way the spider moved, I thought was really cool.
It was cool. Anytime it was a real creature that was just blown up, I'm trying to think what
Empire of the Ants.
Empire of the Ants, yeah, that's a fun one.
That one's almost inexcusable in how...
Well, that's Bert I. Gordon, who in the 50s was making giant person films with, Colossal Man.
And I feel terrible for
Village
not remembering.
Of the Giants.
What this is jumping way in the ahead here. This is the 70s. What is the spider movie that used the VW bug?
We've
Giant Spider Invasion.
Giant Spider Invasion, exactly. Yes, totally.
And we'll talk more about that, too.
Okay, but we're still in the 50s. All right.
No.
Is that spider farting? Oh, it's exhaust.
The other cool thing, though, is you have a really great group of people in this. I mean, you have, like I mentioned, John Agar, Mara Kaday, Leah G. Carroll. You also have Nestor Pava, who was in Creature from the Black Lagoon.
Right.
And what's interesting is in Creature...
Does he play the spider?
No. He actually plays the sheriff, and his accent is completely different. He's one of these character actors you see in a bunch of these movies. And when I first saw him, I go, gosh, his voice sounds like Nestor Pava, but, you know, from Creature from the Black Lagoon, hey, talking like Lucas, but he wasn't like that at all. He was completely different. But, you know, he's an actor, and he was wonderful.
Yeah,
see, okay, I like that movie, but of that time, the movie that I think is much better, especially when it comes to, again, the creature, is Deadly Mantis. Great.
Yeah, 1957.
Yeah.
It was like a marionette, wasn't it?
Yeah.
There were a couple shots, though, where actually a real praying mantis crawling up a scale model.
Yeah.
But the thing about the praying mantis is that they're really freaking cool.
I had
a praying mantis as a pet when I was a kid.
No.
It was great. And I would take my little matchbox cars and put them up, and he'd walk over them.
Oh, that's cool.
Did you film any of it, Sean?
No, it was too young.
Yeah, right.
But I mean, they are really cool creatures, and they kind of look like little monsters anyway. So there were a couple fleeting shots in that film where it uses a real mantis,
But they did a good job in balancing it.
Yeah, no, it was great.
Close-up shots, there's some amazing props.
Yeah, good model work.
Yeah.
No, it's cool, I also like it when they use different, you know, techniques to kind of pull it off.
Yeah.
I'm fine if you know, one of the techniques is using a real praying mantis, but the fact that the majority of it's a puppet, you know, my heart went to it. I was like, okay, I kind of love this.
And whoever crafted that puppet.
Yeah, it's cool.
Did it with love. I mean, it really is magnificent.
And it kind of roars.
Yeah,
like, yeah.
There's a model kit of that, isn't there? Wasn't there?
There was a set of model kits that came out,
right.
And what was really cool is I had most of them. Oh, there was one.
But they were like,
because they're like
generic.
And what was cool is they each came with, this is from the 1970s, and each of the models came with a little cityscape background.
Exactly, yeah.
And there was a praying mantis, which was destroying a train depot.
Yeah, it was awesome.
The wasp was an amusement park.
The mantis and the spider.
Yeah, they're all great.
There was the spider. They were like generic giant.
I think I have the scorpion.
Oh, do you have the scorpion?
Yeah. They're all awesome.
They're all neat. Yeah. I always wanted the wasp, Sean, because the wasp, to me, it had the amusement park.
Yeah,
hey!
That's
right. That was the one I was missing.
Do you know of these?
I would see them. I think I learned of them later. I was at Creature Features in Burbank, a wonderful
place. Oh, right. Yeah.
In Burbank. I had them all. But, you know, and that's the thing as a toy collector, and I always loved dioramas. I mean, it spoke to so many things that I love, which is A, you know, the kind of man in suit, like miniature city. It's a dream of mine to have, like, a miniature city in my home.
Yes.
I don't know if I need a Godzilla suit. I don't know.
I will answer that.
Oh, that would be rad, right? I mean, that would be amazing.
Get up in the morning, put on your Godzilla suit,
get the Godzilla suit and have a friend and you know, just fight in a giant city, a miniature city. That would be awesome.
Yeah.
So the fact that it was kind of like, you know, that there was the creature, that there was the diorama, that it had the city, it just kind of checked off all my geek boxes.
Yeah.
Okay, I have to tell you this because this was really traumatic for me, okay, and these were models that I absolutely loved. I love these things, and like Sean, I was missing the one. And in fifth grade, I was in science class. Our science teacher told us about these great models that are out there. And he bought all of them. I'm like, oh, this is so great. He bought them all. And he goes, yeah, what I did is I put the model together. And the bugs are great, but, you know, the cityscapes, I just threw those away in the box, and I flipped out, and I went...
What a fool.
I didn't call my teacher a fool.
Did you call him a clown?
A clown.
No, but I remember, I said, I could have taken them from you, I could have, and I was so frustrated, but he thought that the actual cityscape was, oh, I was stupid, because this bug is what I really want. And on one hand, I respect it, science teacher who bought the monster model, and he had the insects right in the classroom, but why did you throw away the cityscape?
What an asshole. Yeah. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, I thought this story was going in a different direction. Well, I have these model kits, Larry. They're in my car.
No, come on. No. But the thing that was really frustrating was I remember it as if it was yesterday. It still disturbs me when he did.
It would make me very upset.
Larry has a lot of childhood pain that's just bubbling right at the surface at all times. And we tap that energy and turn it into something wonderful.
You know, yeah, those were great models.
Now, I don't want to... This is so cool, and I love the way we're going, but Mike, I want to find out about...
What's wrong with talking about deadly mantis?
Nothing.
We were just talking about deadly mantis. That's actually on topic.
And I must confess, see, my interest is not only just monster movies, it also goes to the merchandise and the things, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, surrounding. We talked about toys. We talked about...
So most of my mind usually goes from movies to toys, and that's just a...
Oh, no, you're gonna fit in just fine.
Call it a character flaw, I don't know, but that's kind of where it goes. But I mean, if we're going back then the other one that I kind of left a bit of an impact, and I did learn about these movies a little later, they weren't the ones that I loved as a kid. Like, when I was a kid, it was all about Freddy Krueger and Jason and things like that.
Right.
Earth versus the Spider would be...
Absolutely. Another Burt I. Gordon.
That's one where it is... It's like, it's either a fake spider leg.
Right.
Or it was the, you know, magnified spider
exactly
in the cave.
Yeah, exactly.
But what I loved about that one, there's a scene in that movie that I really love. They've killed the spider, and rather than have
supposedly
the government, supposedly,
right,
rather than have like the government come pick this thing up, you know, yeah, and take it to right a place to study it or whatever, they've got it like in the gym.
high school like jamboree.
Yeah, like, and they're like, oh, there's the spider. Like, oh, it's dead. Don't worry. Hey, let's rehearse our band.
Well, that one had a very interesting flavor because, you know, we talked earlier before the show about being a hep cat. You know, that one was full of hep cats. I mean, that movie
there was a lot of hep cats.
That
yeah
movie was the bee's knees, man. That movie was the cat's pajamas.
That's true.
It was crazy, daddy-o. Yeah. So it very much spoke to kind of that like kind of 50s, you know.
Yes,
but
yes,
kid kind of,
the fact that the spider comes alive right when they're having basically their
it hates
own private
music
sock hop.
It hates rock and roll.
Totally.
Boy, that's, you know, that says a lot, Sean. No,
imagine,
really.
Like, kind of a take on like Shaun of the Dead where the spider comes alive and just kills the band and then dies.
But that movie also had an added element of that was in a cave. It
right.
Was in, you know,
yeah, that was
all
cool.
The couple,
like that.
And they fell in the giant web in the cave.
Yeah.
It was
the web
cool
was always cool, too.
Yeah, it was like that.
It's like,
it's
oh, where'd
rope
you get that net? You know, yeah. Fishing net.
Is this the one, which is the, I'm trying to think of the poster for this one. Is this the one that
has
the spider?
Skull.
This, yeah.
Yes,
it,
yes.
It has a skull on a head of the spider.
Right. Now, did you think that that was going to be in the movie?
That would have been interesting.
Honestly, Matt, when you put a picture of a spider-like creature with a human skull on it, that's what I think I'm going to see.
Or like
it's quite possible considering that time.
Yeah, or like Roger Corman's The Wasp Woman, which has a
yes
great poster of
great
a giant
poster
wasp with a yeah woman's head attacking this helpless guy, and that's not in the movie at all.
Right. Yeah, totally.
But it was a cool poster, though.
Wasted opportunity.
Yes.
But getting back to this, and the web, it's a big, it's kind of like a rope web.
Yeah.
And it, but it's designed, it's done like a web, though.
Yeah,
it's
yeah
kind of, I mean,
was it?
Kind of, well,
I don't think
James
so. I don't remember it. I remember it looking like a net that they kind of added some fuzzy stuff
yeah
to the to make it look a little
right
more.
Right.
But a web would be sticky, too, and they don't really stick to it, if I
yeah
recall.
They kind of wrap their arms under it, so like, oh, I'm stuck, I'm
yeah
stuck.
Yeah.
I mean, so the spider stuff is just great. Now, Mike, you did a spider movie.
I did.
You did
I
a
did
couple
called
spider movies.
Big-ass spider.
Yes, tell us about this.
From 2013.
Yes. Well, I mean, look, I can't say that it was like this dream of mine that I'm like, I want to make a giant spider film.
Really?
No, not at all. It was definitely...
Are you serious?
No, yeah, it was definitely one of those situations. I had done Gravedancers, and at that point, I was really hoping...
Which is another great movie.
Oh, thank you.
We all love that.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. I was hoping that Gravedancers would kind of, you know, get me on the studio path and like make bigger films, and nothing happened. It like killed my career, and I didn't...
I didn't
work for 6 years as a director, at least. That's when I started editing and stuff like that. Was kind of like...
Note to self.
Exactly, totally. And so that was a disappointment, and then the only movie I was offered, or well, I shouldn't say that, but the next one that was kind of like a real thing is, you know, I got this script called Dino Spider, and this is pre-Sharknado, so that wasn't even like a semi-cool thing at the time. Yeah, you know, it was kind of like, all right, this is a low-end sci-fi movie, and it really kind of bummed me out. I was kind of like, shit, man, really, it's come to this, and so I read it, and it was. You know, it wasn't great. And then, you know, I had kind of one of those life-changing moments that I was like, look, I mean, I'm looking down on this for some reason. And I feel for some reason I'm better than this, and I'm not. You know, it largely is up to me.
Aren't you?
No, I don't know. I mean, it's largely up to me to determine what that movie is. You know, I can say, oh, this is a piece of crap, and you know, and phone it in and will it to be that way.
Right.
Or I can take it seriously, and I can, you know, kind of look back at the classic giant monster movies of yesteryear, and of them particularly was one of the big influences. And I just sort of kind of dug deep, and I'm like, how can I make this work? How can I make this cool? And so that's kind of how it began. Eventually, they wanted to title it Mega Spider. It was a company called Epic Pictures, who are dear friends and were the producers of it. And the backstory of it is just this very simple thing that they were a foreign sales company, and they were going off asking their buyers, what kind of movies do you want? It's like, oh, Nazi zombie movie. And I'm like, oh. Well, there's a lot of those. What else do you want? Someone said, you know what sells is a giant creature features, like a giant spider movie or something like that. And they're like, okay, yeah, we'll make a giant spider movie. Okay, cool. And so
they all talk that way.
They all talk that way. That's the guy. That's the low budget.
We want insects of some kind.
The kids love insects. You know, it doesn't mean like Europe. It doesn't matter.
Spiders are hip now.
And so you know, they came to me with a script. I thought it was so, but then I was like, let me rewrite it. Let me, you know, kind of do the sci-fi channel movie that I would want, because I must admit, I was very excited by the title Sharktopus or Mega Shark versus what the hell was that first one?
Dino Python.
Well, all of those, I wanted to like them. I like, there was something that was kind of charming about that.
There's always like a good 10 minutes in them that you go like, okay.
Not really though. It's like, Fair enough. I tune in, and it was nothing but disappointment. It was always kind of like, you know, people talking, and the thing is that they always took it very seriously for whatever reason, and I never quite understand that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, no, I want to do kind of a Shaun of the Dead kind of thing, and I like funny characters. I like my horror serious, you know, I like the creature to be like a real threat, but I like dumb bumbling characters. And the script, the one absolutely thing that I must give the screenwriter, Greg Garris, who wrote the original screenplay of Mega Spider or Dino Spider, whatever you want to call it, was that he had a funny dynamic between this exterminator and a security guard that had to save the city.
That really falls through into the film too, because that's a great.
No, it was great, and it was more a buddy cop movie.
So I
sort of saw the potential of more what it could be, and I did a draft, and you know, the producers may deny this now, but they thought it was terrible. They were like, well, you know, there's no suspense in this. Where's the suspense in the giant spider movie? What is this? You know,
where's the rock band?
And I wanted to to just bang my head against the wall because I was like, it's a giant spider movie. It's not, because I'm sorry. And look, maybe I just can't figure it out. I don't think you can truly make a scary film with a giant spider. You can make a scary film with little spiders or even medium-sized spiders, but it's too crazy of an idea that you know, you're not going to get the creepy
crawlies. It's a different aesthetic.
Absolutely.
It can be like really, you know, exciting and kind of shocking, but it's a different kind of creepy.
Yeah, but it's not going to be scary. You're not going to make, oh, it's the Exorcist of giant bug movies.
Mysterious Island, that Ray Harryhausen movie.
Sure, yeah.
Is a great movie. It's not a scary movie.
No.
It's an exciting movie. It's suspenseful.
It's adventurous.
I don't know if I'd say any. I mean, we've talked about a lot of great movies here, but I don't know if I'd call any of them scary.
You could go the route of Starship Troopers, which is more of an action
That's
movie.
That's more an action movie.
We'll get to that, but I will say this. You know, you, Mike, you're Mr. I make big-ass spider movies. Oh, I like spiders. There are a lot of people out there that freak out at spiders.
Oh, no, for
and it's like,
sure.
We are yes, look, because I know, I want to be very clear, we're kind of making light of this. Look, I live with a couple of females who, spider comes in the room,
right,
and they literally flip out.
No, did you get divorced? oh, you mean your wife and your kid. I got it.
Yes.
I thought you started a new life in Mexico.
In Big Ass Spider, though, there's a spider that grows.
Yes.
When it's kind of like almost like the size of like a small, like a kitten or something,
right?
That is kind of a
that's when you can make
when
it
it's
scary.
Coming through the vents. And
that's the thing. And so I did try to actually kind of make that stuff atmospheric because, I learned through the making of it how much arachnophobia exists in the world.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
I have always thought spiders are actually kind of cool creatures. I think they're pretty neat.
Yeah.
But I have the Xanti misfit in front of me. So
you're caressing its ass.
Exactly. So, anyway, so I've always thought they're very cool creatures and whatnot. But oh, my God, they can, you know, they can paralyze people just by its presence.
Serious phobias.
And if anything, I regret not taking a little more advantage of that because I think I learned it through the process of making it how much people would. I remember when we premiered at South by Southwest, which again was a rowdy, you know, type of crowd. There's beer and all sorts of things. But there were people that came into the theater. I remember a couple came in and she couldn't handle it. It's a digital spider. I thought like, okay, it's a CG spider. No one's really going to like be upset by this, but it freaked them out. They had to leave 10 minutes into the movie because they couldn't take the little spider stuff.
Can I say there's a quality about that movie that I love so much, which is the fact that you do set up these characters. They're likable. They're funny. There are some funny scenarios. You've got this building story of the spider.
Yeah.
But when the spider stuff hits,
right,
it's balls to the wall.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we're going to make a giant creature movie. Right. We're going to make a giant creature movie.
And that's, to me, like, what was great about it is that it shocked me because it was like, oh, man, you are not holding back.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, when the spider hits, it really hits. And so there was an element of genuine horror for me where I was like, wow.
There's a couple of good
ups. You played the horror of the giant spider.
Well, that's the thing. Is that I wanted, and this is, you know, we work on a show that might or might not
I'm
be
not
named
familiar.
In this. Yes. and that's sort of the key to it is that you treat, and this is sort of my thing that with the kind of like Sci-Fi Channel movies and stuff like that, is that they ever treat the evil or the monster seriously.
Yeah.
Right. It's always kind of a joke. It's always kind of like, and they, you know, and I made a sci-fi.
It's backwards almost. Like,
yes, exactly.
They treat everything else seriously except the monster.
Right, yeah. Exactly. And what I never got in sync with Sci-Fi Channel movies, and I made one. We can talk about that afterwards. You know, is that they? And I don't want to say they, but often many of the producers have this thing of like, oh, we're making a so bad it's good movie, I don't get that. I don't understand that. Because,
it's trying to make a cult film,
right? Because you can't purposefully make a so bad it's good movie. Yeah, Sharknado, which is, you know, an enjoyable film all into its own right, I wouldn't even categorize as a so bad it's good movie, you know.
And they had no idea that was going to hit.
Right. You know, something like Deathbed, The Bed That Eats.
Well,
that movie is a so bad it's good movie.
Sure.
I'm sure we all have our favorites. Mine is a musical from Golden Globus called The Apple.
Oh my God. Love The Apple.
One of Sean's favorites.
Oh my God, we've seen that at midnight. We wore little
Apple.
BIM.
You got a BIM
signs,
mark. Oh,
BIM
yes.
marks. Yes.
BIM.
Oh my God. BIM's on the way. Track. Oh my God.
Yeah, no, I could do a solo here.
We have to do an episode on the apple.
Yeah, but we're going to have our apple episode. Yeah. But you know what I think is really cool is there are certain rules that a spider has to play by. And what's interesting about about this is this particular spider actually does things that typical spiders don't do, which gives it that added extra element of, oh my gosh, I don't know what this spider is going to be doing.
Sure, sure. Yeah.
And also there's a really cool moment too when I guess a spider sprays something at someone and the guy actually melts.
It's a really good face melting scene, actually.
Dude, Mike, when I saw him, went, whoa!
Oh, nice. That was
That's what I'm saying. And, is that the horror is played straight.
And the other
thing. It's very Raiders of the Lost Ark. I mean,
oh, 100%. That was one of my favorite movies.
What else is really neat is whereas I think of a spider as being like furry and hairy. This one's not. It's more like a shell kind
of thing.
Well, the thing
is that you know,
different kinds of spiders.
I truly have that love of monsters. It's not fake, you know, it's real. And so I was really kind of thinking, you know, looking at kind of the movies of yore, you know, looking at tarantula and stuff. And it's like, I don't think furry, hairy spiders are scary. I like, you know, because of them,
right,
partially, right. And, sure. And because of Alien, funny enough, is I like the hard-shelled creatures. And my favorite spider, legitimately, no bullshit, because, you know, partially growing up kind of a goth kid, is the Black Widow. The Black Widow is a beautiful and elegant-looking spider and deadly.
We have one crawling up there behind
you. Yeah. Yes, totally. Yeah. And so when I saw the Black Widow, and I loved how long its legs are and the lanky thing, and I was like, that's really cool. And it being a lover of King Kong, I was like, God, I'd love to, you know, we were shooting in LA because, you know.
That's awesome, buddy.
You know, I was
awesome.
Like, let's have it go up to the tallest building in LA and do kind of a King Kong thing.
And that's the other thing, too, that I felt really worked that I haven't seen work in too many other films is that you got the creature in broad daylight.
Right.
And it's still scary.
But here's the thing. Freaky. I mean, most of the things you're mentioning, it's sort of funny. It's all kind of like, you know, putting it in perspective now because it's, you know, now 5 years ago, is that most of these things are all happy accidents. You know, it's like you're given, here's the parameter you have to work with. We can't afford to shoot at night. You know, so you're and again, all these things form the decisions you make. We can't shoot at night. So when I was watching the movie District 9, which is another fabulous film,
great.
And hearing that director talk about his approach to special effects, he's like, look, what works well when you're in direct sunlight is hard shells. You know, it's like, you know, fur or kind of like gelatinous type stuff, that's not going to work. But something that kind of can reflect the sun, you know, like direct light.
It's probably more expensive too, right?
To do what?
A hairy
probably
spider?
Probably.
Right. I thought fur is kind of
it's
more
just more intricate. So off of that, I was like, well, I like the Black Widow as it is. I have to shoot in daylight. Let's kind of go with that. The melting, the face melting thing, that's a kind of just a wacky story. Again, it's funny how movies come together. Sometimes you have really bad luck and things don't go your way, and sometimes they do. So we were offered and again, it was a mixed blessing, but we were offered this this chance. It's like, you guys want to be part of a reality show? It'll be good. I don't know why everyone talks in the kind of
because it's fun.
Because
it's fun.
You want to be at a reality show? You know, this effects house offered us is like, we'll give you $15,000 worth of effects if you would be on this reality show called Monster Man on Sci-Fi.
Oh yes, I've heard that show. Yeah, I know some people worked on that show. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. That's so cool.
So now I had to come up with like effects that I wasn't planning because originally it was all going to be digital, which I didn't want to do. I actually very much tried, and I'm glad, you know, people talked me out of it, and you learn that I wanted to do it all stop motion.
That was going to be my question too, if like you wanted to do not CGI but try to do
100%. I wanted to do stop motion, when you're doing independent films, when you're running and gunning like that, what they can do now as far as like track marks and things like that and just tracking things to a building and stuff like that, you couldn't do it. And, you know, I mean,
and
the time and everything, it would be more expensive. It would be difficult and it probably wouldn't look that good.
Right. I have to admit, for all the Sci-Fi Channel type movies and kind of comparison, the big ass spider, the CGI is pretty good.
Okay,
and that's another
happy accident. Again, it's just so funny how these things. So really fast, I'll finish with the face melting thing. So this company called SodaFX, you know, were being featured on the show Monster Man, and cool. So if we would be guinea pigs and have people, you know, shoot our experiences, you know, we would get $15,000 in effects. Other than the melting head, I didn't end up using any of the practical effects because God bless them. Just didn't work out, and you can watch the episode, which is all about SodaFX, where yours truly is the villain of that episode. I am the asshole director that's like, no, we're gonna do it CG. Screw your puppets.
Did you use that voice the whole time?
I mean, it was interesting. It's like, look, I'm coming at it of just trying to make the best movie.
Sure,
but
of course.
Boy, was I portrayed it, and you know, as those who work in reality.
If you talk in that voice, it probably does go down easier, right?
It probably does.
You mean they twisted around what really happened on a reality?
But the melting thing I thought was cool, and I thought it worked.
It worked great, but I knew that was Raiders of the Lost Ark is my favorite movie, and I felt like, well, that would be a cool kill, like just some spider venom, and we'll just kind of do an old school thing. And because we had a lot of digital effects in there, you know, my thing now and what I've grown to, as much as I love practical effects, and 100% I do, what I really love now is the integration of practical effects with digital help.
The Marvel films do that really well.
And so I was like, you know what I've never seen is actually starting with a real face and then it kind of essentially morphing it while the fake head melts.
Right. That's
cool. It's like I've never seen that. And so I was like, I think that that's a pretty effective thing that isn't too complicated.
Right.
But I think we can pull it off, and I think we did.
Totally.
So the digital effects, the reason that were far better than expected is because we got solicited by a company in Pakistan that they were like, we want to do effects for American movies. This company.
Did they talk like this even in Pakistan?
Exactly. We want to do giant spider movies for you Americans.
I'm Saul Bin Laden.
What we want to do is create terror and be pictures.
So there was a foreign company that reached out to you.
Yeah, it was a company called Ice Animation, and we paid them $90,000 for all our CG effects.
Wow!
And they treated it like we were making. Yeah, absolutely. They treated it like we were making, a
Titanic.
Michael Bay film. Yeah, exactly. And they really gave it their all, and so I think that's why the effects kind of.
It looks great. It really does.
Yeah, we're very fortunate.
There was a moment that I really, really love, and I haven't seen. One thing is when my wife or kid, when they see a spider and it runs across the floor really fast, they flip out. And imagine, for listeners, if you're watching this film, that the little spider has gotten so big, and the main characters, they have a truck, they try to ram into it, and then they realize, oh my gosh, this is a huge spider. They turn around and try to take off, and the spider, in its giant size, runs after them.
It's
really cool, because I thought to myself, wow, as hokey as it may be, it's like, here's a giant spider racing after you, and you're in a truck trying to go as fast as you can.
It's kind of like the opposite of what people used to think was when you had something big, you would slow everything down, and you would make it look big and lumbering.
Right. Now these things move.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Spiders are very fast, and one of the things that happened on the reality show was, because they set you in situations that happen in real life, they were like, so here was the scenario. They had us supposedly just drop into the effects thing where they just supposedly happened to have some spider experts who just happened to have some deadly spiders they wanted to show us. And so this guy had all these different black hissing tarantulas and black widows and all sorts of shit. And one of them literally got loose.
It came
straight at me. That one's the director. He speaks that way too. That was the director. Get him. But they are so fast.
I mean, I didn't
even have time to be afraid. It was a
tarantula?
It was a black hissing tarantula, which my understanding was that it was poisonous and his bite was very painful.
Oh, wow.
Now, here's the thing. It's only this big. It's coming at you.
Only as big as that?
Yeah.
Pointed to a Xanti misfit, which, if anything that size came at me.
But the thing is, I'm 5'10", okay? 5'9", all right.
So it looks bigger.
My instinct was, I'm going to crush that thing. It may have come at me at full vigor, but I my, you know, survival instinct sure, was to step on it. And the guy was like, don't step on it. It's really expensive. you know, and he was able to catch it. But you know,
no, that's terrifying.
But it made me realize how fast and how deadly these things are. And they move like lightning. Right, I mean, right.
Larry had a birthday party for his daughter.
Uh-huh.
And he brought this guy who had Mr. Valentine, who had all these
reptiles,
and like a wallaby
bounce around the backyard.
Oh, nice.
Then what's cool is here's a guy who was bringing the stuff for all these kids to check out to show don't be afraid of these creatures, snake. And
I held a tarantula in my hand.
Your wife, who was afraid of scorpions, got to hold a scorpion.
And snakes?
I was terrified.
Really?
I held one, but it was like, okay, get it away.
Was it a scorpion?
I have no problem.
I think it was a spider. Any of those things terrify me.
Go ahead, Matt.
But what I remember the most from that day was that he had black widows.
Oh, wow.
And he had a black widow that I guess was pregnant.
Yeah.
And literally giving birth at the moment.
Holy shit.
And so he was showing, he was like, look, see, this egg sac. And he would pull out these little strands of these little black widow eggs. Uh-huh. And they would go everywhere.
And he would throw them in the air.
And so he's like, oh, no, it's fine. The insects don't want to hurt
your yard.
And they're going all over Larry's yard.
But that's how, I ended up learning a lot about spiders because we had a partner, Western Exterminator.
I was going to say, used Western Exterminator. That was famous.
That was another thing growing up in Los Angeles. I just always loved the little guy.
With the mallet behind his.
Yeah, you root for the rat.
It's
the mouth.
Cool. So imagine, for our listeners, if you're not familiar with it, it is very famous. On the back of these exterminator trucks, there's an actual figure of what looks like to be an undertaker with a top hat. And
he looks kind of like the Monopoly guy.
Yes.
And
he's bending down to kind of look at a rat. And behind his back, he's holding a mallet.
Yes. Right.
It's a little, very famous little
character.
But the
mouse looks so like, hey, friend.
No. He has a little, like, a gangster hat on. And he's got, like a little switchblade
like
or something.
The Little Rascals.
Yeah. But sometimes,
does a rat have a switchblade? I don't remember that.
Wait, what's sad is sometimes if you pass some of these trucks, sometimes they get vandalized and sometimes the rat is missing. And
people try to take them all the time.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's the thing. It's my love for figurines and toys. Like even as a kid, I was like, I always love that. So when it's funny. You're making me realize how much of this stuff is just happy accidents. We couldn't afford a exterminator truck. You know, it's such a low budget movie. We were like, well, we can't afford to make one. And so we tried to like maybe we could make a deal with an actual exterminator.
Sure. Yeah.
Right. And so without question, I was immediately like, Western Exterminator.
Yeah.
We got to go to them. And they were cool with it.
That's
so
awesome.
So they donated it was a hell of a commercial for them.
Sure.
You know.
And proud.
What's great is so your main character, who is an exterminator, I mean, he's not a buffoon. He's a good guy. And he knows his stuff.
Yes. Greg Gumberg.
Yeah. And I wanted to ask
such a likable actor.
I wanted to ask about your casting because you got him. Granted, it's not Harrison Ford, but you did get a good guy.
He's great.
And also
we got Ray Wise.
And Ray Wise.
Yeah.
You got a guy from Twin Peaks.
Yeah. You got a cameo by Lloyd Kaufman from Trauma Films.
Yeah,
that's
absolutely
awesome. He gets eaten by a spider.
Fantastic.
Yeah, no, totally. I mean, again, it's like I love genre films and the more of familiar faces and genre people that I could get in there.
Sure.
You know, obviously, I would be for it. I mean, if anything, you're making me like, man, I want to make a second one.
You know, it's so funny because as I'm watching the film, I got all excited because I saw a guy who was a friend of mine, a Brian Olay, who was
Playboy Radio,
Playboy Mansion Mia, terrific guy. You know, he was on The Girls Next Door, and all of a sudden he's in your movie.
Well,
he's in there's the park area, and he's like videotaping, and then all of a sudden the spider comes in, and I talked to him. But when I saw the film, I reached out to Brian. I said, Brian, what's the deal? You were in this film, and he goes, yes, Larry, it was one of my most favorite death scenes I've ever had.
Nice.
So, and what's cool is there's spider when he's running around in the park. He has this special ability where he sprays a web at someone and then pulls them into his mouth.
Right, right.
Not like what a spider would do.
Oh, I really like killing people.
Yes,
so,
and Brian doesn't really have a web thing. He has like, there's like a
stabbing.
I don't want to give it. Yeah, but it's a great scene. But
that was a fun one. A couple things on that. So Josh Friedman, my first AD, is a bartender at the Playboy Mansion,
was. Oh, wow. Small world.
And so he knew Brian from that, and Brian loved horror movies, and so he was like, look, I think the deal was, again, because it is a B movie, and I did want to revel in its B roots. So it was like, you know, it took place at Elysian Park, and I'm like, okay, this isn't realistic whatsoever, but let's fill it with a bunch of hot girls.
Yes, I noticed that.
Yeah, playing volleyball.
Playing volleyball.
In bikinis.
And I'm like, how?
Not the beach.
And I'm like, how are we gonna get?
That's what I like about your film is you also play the sexy real.
I'm like, how are we gonna get all these hot girls, you know, to come out for one of my movies? You know, and so they were like, you know, if we cast Brian Olea, he's got a hook on. And so that was the thing. If we give him a good death, Brian would come out.
Awesome.
Also, fun fact, and this is a hardly known fact, the second unit director of that scene of that big park is James Wan, who directed The Conjuring.
Oh, wow.
What?
And now Aquaman. Yes,
oh,
yes.
No.
Wow.
Yes,
fantastic.
Yes.
Awesome.
It's a small world.
Yes, little known fun fact. But,
and maybe for the sequel, I'm just thinking maybe a group of four bumbling
or like four guys who love to talk about monsters who are get angry
monsters. We have wanted to do a sequel since the beginning. The production company Epic, for whatever reason, doesn't want to do it. It pains me because, especially as we talked about them, it was a giant ant movie.
Yeah.
The idea was to do a big ass something.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, like a franchise.
Yeah, franchise.
I hate to give away. I'm not going to give away the ending, but big ass.
Oh sure, sure. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Absolutely.
Right.
But,
right.
Yes. I don't. I guess we won't say. It's on streaming everywhere. But, in Boulay. I
don't
want to
ruin because that's such a great moment, though.
Right. Sure.
Right. Right.
And I don't even know how we would deal it because I wanted to do a giant ant movie because it actually was my brother who came up with this one. It was even though it, ideally it was supposed to be like big ass scorpion or big ass centipede, it was going to be big ass spider 2, Rise of the Mexicants.
Nice.
So Jose's family, his town was in trouble in Mexico because the cartel was using this technology to breed giant ants to build drug tunnels.
What an interesting idea.
Yeah. But you know, the production company just don't want to do it. You know, they just we've tried. We all want to do it. All the cast, all the
This too podcast. Close to home,
oh my god. And then the wall is built, right?
Right, exactly.
Oh, yeah,
right.
Wow. Oh, it would be so good.
So good.
You know what? You may need to revisit this.
Yes.
I know. I mean, no, we seriously
so
want to do it, but
ripe.
but it's just an upsetting thing. They've just never, and I don't know why, because the movie it was a $600,000 movie. It was successful for its budget.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we sold internationally.
I don't know anyone who I know who's seen it who didn't like it.
Yeah, it's really fun.
No, it's fun. I mean, I had a good time with it.
Oh, thank you. Thanks. So who knows? I mean, maybe it'll happen again. Either way, I'd like to do another movie with Greg and Lombardo. But so much of it is luck. You know, so much of it is the fact that Greg is so charismatic and that worked. And,
yeah,
and
really
then
good.
I was thinking like, oh, you know, that guy from Napoleon Dynamite, he's good. And he's like, no, I've got a guy who would be a great like Latino sidekick, you know?
Yeah.
And sure enough, it's the chemistry of them.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Which is something that I have so little control over. I mean, all my, you know, contribution is it to know to feed it and rely on it and kind of, you know, use it that makes that movie work. But there's so many things that could have gone wrong with it, but didn't. I want to finish up one fun little story about the Pakistan
stuff.
Please. Yeah.
Was another worry for us is that, you know, because they were building a CGI city, you know, is that we were sending all these like blueprints and models, scale models and computer scans of downtown LA and wiring all this money to Pakistan.
Did you get a call? Suddenly you're getting calls.
I'm pretty sure we had to have been on a watch list.
Sure.
If not, we should have been.
Anyway, but I wonder if somebody in Homeland Security just went, oh, it's just a giant Spider-Man.
It's fine.
That's hilarious.
Anyway, but yeah, no, a lot of it is a happy accident, you know, but you know, I'm really happy how far the movie went. You know, again, I started it as just with the attitude of like, God, I haven't done a movie in 6 years. This is will be like a good exercise. Maybe nobody will see it. And I'll just sort of like kind of do this while I try to get my next thing. And then eventually you get into it and you fall in love with it and you fall in love with the process and you know, and something special happens.
It's also a nice lesson, too, of the fact that you were able to get into this thing that initially wasn't necessarily the first thing on your mind to make.
Right.
But you made it your own.
You find the love and you find the place of what how can you make this cool and how could it be good? And the other thing is that, you know, I'm kind of known for kind of violent movies.
That's what I like about you.
Yeah. But the fun thing, and one of the fun things, even though there's actually a massive death count in the movie, but, you know, part of the biggest audience for this movie was kids, you know.
I can share that.
Kids love
it
because the naughtiest thing about it was the title. You know, there's no bad, right, there's no bad words in the movie. There's no nudity. There's no, you know, there's monster violence, but there's not.
Right.
No one's getting torn apart or like, you know, their guts taken out.
So the title.
Yes.
Because you said it was originally going to be Mega Spider.
Mega Spider.
I assume you really fought for Big Ass. Because
for 2 years.
Because Big Ass is perfect.
Yeah, two years I fought, because I don't know why, and I can't say that I'm always right about these things, because often I am totally misguided titles and things like that. I'm just, you know, but I just sort of had it deep in my soul that, no, this movie should be called Big Ass Spider, and I would say it on set every day, and they're like, no, the buyers aren't going to know what a big ass is. They're not going to know what a big ass is in Turkey, you know. So no, Mega Spider's international, that's going to, like, God, you're limiting what the movie is. I think the movie's going to go so much further if you call it Big Ass Spider, you know?
Because no rap music ever makes it beyond our shores. No one can ever understand any of that slang.
And we did have some strange little backlashes. I mean, you know, in Japan, the movie is Mega Spider. The funniest one is that Walmart... And this actually kind of was a failure for us, but Walmart would carry the movie if we changed the title to Biggest Spider.
What?
Wow. Yeah, so there's...
So just for Walmart?
Just for Walmart, there are DVDs that, you know, it's the big ass logo, but it's crossed out, and then EST is, or GEST, you know, Biggest Spider. And then if you leave the fine print, it says, AKA Big Ass Spider. it's sort of what the point, but we did it.
We are such children.
And then it kind of flopped at Walmart. It really didn't sell that well. Yeah.
Wow, what a surprise.
And all of a sudden, we had 19,000 Biggest Spider DVDs returned to us.
Oh, man. Those are collector's items now.
I don't think so, because there are 19,000 of them hanging around. So I'd like them to be collector's items. I wish.
Wow, Biggest Spider is so catchy. It's funny.
Yeah, it's innocent, though.
But Mega Spider, like, that would have jumped off the racks.
No, I don't think so. I really feel that the movie would have kind of faded, you know, away like so many
it
movies.
It sounds
do.
Like every yeah, other
like every
movie.
Other
no,
right,
Big
totally,
Ass Spider is perfect for the tone.
Yeah, exactly.
Agreed.
It nails it.
So, and, you know, we were super blessed. We got into South by Southwest, which is, you know, it was a prestigious film festival, and we got into lots of film festivals, and I felt, I'm back, baby. I'm done to do it. I'm gonna make bigger movies now. I'm waiting for the phone to ring. The phone didn't ring. The phone rang eventually, like a year later, and it was Sci-Fi Channel, and they're like, can you make a big spider movie for us now? and thus was born Lavalantula.
So how was that experience?
Lavalantula.
Because obviously that movie is even more of a comical approach. It's more poking fun at its... I mean,
well, I'm wondering if
comical in a different way. Right?
Yeah, I'm wondering if the network asked you to have it that.
I was
that kind
I
of
was
tone.
I was making a movie for them.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
It seemed like a less personal project. Right?
Absolutely, it is literally, and again, and I learned a
there
lot.
Is some. Fun in that
no,
movie.
No, absolutely. I mean, look, I love the idea that, you know, we reunited the cast of Police Academy.
Steve Guttenberg as this, like, washed-up 90s action star.
Yeah,
that's funny.
I mean, I definitely had fun of it. It's just, you know, I kind of learned it, and it was an important lesson to learn, especially as I, you know, want to get more into television directing and stuff like that it's not your baby, you know? You're part of a team. The network wants their movie. You're lucky to, you know, put yourself in there.
Sure. I mean, it's work, though, too.
And absolutely. Like, and the thing was that at that time, Sharknado was a massive hit.
Right, right.
And they wanted Sharknado, you know, and I didn't want to make Sharknado, you know. Right. And so I would get these notes constantly. And it was very demoralizing at the time of, like, you know what we did in Sharknado. let me tell you why Sharknado works and why your movie doesn't. It's Sharknado, you know. And their whole thing,
like, they know.
Their whole thing was that if the concept is so preposterous, but you treat it seriously, that's funny. And I'm like, no, you know what's funny is funny characters saying funny things, doing funny things, and you know, reacting to a preposterous situation, sure. And so I feel that LAVALANTULA is very much a hybrid of Sharknado meets Big Ass Spider. It's sort of like, you know, and again, we met somewhere in the middle. It was a hit for them. They made a sequel, which I was not asked to be a part of. Yes.
Oh, wow.
And yes, which actually I love the title, Two Lava, Two Lantula.
Oh, wow.
Is that really the title?
Yeah, Two Lava, Two Lantula.
Now, so...
it's pretty great.
So how was it working with Steve Guttenberg and all the Police Academy folks?
One of the best people on earth.
Really?
He is such
he's having a fun time.
He is a human ray of sunshine.
Really? A human ray of sunshine.
He is.
The man who gave us Tower of Terror, Matt.
Yes.
You remember?
Exactly. And some of his finest work. And you know, we had a Tower of Terror reunion because Nia Peoples is the lead in Tower of Terror. And
who I read, by the way. She's great.
Cast her in LAVALANTULA because of that. So
because of Tower of Terror, she's
pretty lovely.
She's a cute.
Oh, she's great. Yeah, totally, absolutely. No, and she's great. No, I mean, there was a lot of fun that we had making that movie. There was a lot of really cool actors.
Ralph Garman from K-Rock, because
I was a K-Rock fan and listened to him every morning, and he was always and God's honest truth, he was just a big, for no reason, not prompted, was just a big supporter of Big Ass Spider.
I would
talk about it on the radio and stuff, and so I wanted to return the favor, and I wrote him a part.
That's awesome.
In this, and we had fun. I mean, you know, I don't love the movie. I think it's fine. I think there's some okay stuff, but yeah, it was a fun experience to do. You know, so it was interesting. So,
the scene with the Starline tour bus. That was inspired.
That was
fun.
Yeah, there was definitely stuff that was very me. The attack on Hollywood Boulevard. That's like the type of stuff.
Raiders of the Lost Ark. Homage with it's the globe on the Ripley's Believe It or Not building.
Right.
Comes loose and starts rolling. And there's a guy in an Indiana Jones hat running from it.
That's funny.
And left up to me, I would have gone much further with it. But everyone was afraid. Oh, we're gonna get sued or whatever.
Because there was
the saw puppet on a tricycle was running from the.
Oh wow!
Was running from the spiders and all sorts of shit. But it was a fine experience. But it's not one that I feel came from the heart. It was just a team effort.
But I
think largely television is that way. You know, it's the role of a director in television is very different than the role of a director in a feature because you are there for the showrunner, the writers in charge, or the producers in charge, or the networks in charge. You know, you were just, you know, one of the people trying to make it happen. So that was kind of my thing.
But at the end of the day,
yes,
you are a horror fan.
Yes,
making a lava tarantula movie.
Sure. Yeah, in Hollywood,
which is, there's got to be always a part in you. I'm assuming that's like, my worst day, this is still pretty damn cool.
Well, that was the thing. It's like, I realized, look, I can sit at home all summer and be unemployed, or Steve Guttenberg could fight lava spiders on Hollywood Boulevard.
Exactly. Right. Exactly.
And I love B movies. I do. I know that might not be a here. I understand.
I can say
But in Hollywood, you can't say I want to make B movies. I want to make schlocky pictures.
Can I ask you this though? Because I feel like maybe things are changing in that direction, just considering the fact that, one, you've got every big blockbuster is a science fiction movie. Horror movies, almost every horror movie now that comes out is a minor blockbuster at least.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And then you have all these television shows on top of it and Stranger Things. We're getting to a place now where the line between what is considered, quote unquote, a B movie and a movie...
Right.
Are being, yeah, the lines
no,
are being
I mean, blurred. I remember, you know, we interviewed John Landis for a documentary that we made, and he was kind of saying, you know, it's like, look, when I was growing up, you know, the B movies were, you know, Tarantula and these kind of things, and the important movies were,
the
Grapes of Wrath and all that kind of thing. But now... the A movies are like Spider-Man and like the Avengers and like comic book movies and creature films and Alien and things like that. It's like, and now, so his point was like, now there's not really such a thing as B movies. It's just all crap. You
know? See, now I wouldn't jump to that place.
Right.
But we consider it the golden age.
Well, it's funny because I think, just because your budget isn't the biggest budget, it doesn't necessarily mean that, well, I'm just going to try and cut corners and make a schlocky, shitty film.
Sure.
And what I loved about what you did, Mike, whether it was, you know, lucky, with the money that you guys had, you really got the best. You got so much out of this money, whether it be the special effects, the visual effects, the talent, and I mean, there's a lot of stuff that's crammed in this.
Not to be all sappy, but I think the important element that's missing on a lot of these things is love. You know,
it comes from a
true love of the genre,
a
respect for everything that came before it, and a love of like, I want to be entertained. What is the movie I want to see or whatever?
And you can tell when you watch those sci-fi movies. You know, there's a handful where you go, oh, hey,
right, sure.
somebody loved this movie.
Right, yeah, exactly. Right. Yeah, totally. And that's, you know, as I mentioned to you guys before, is like I had a television as a side job and stuff like that. And the reason I do that is because when I direct, I want to give it everything. I only want to do the stuff that I absolutely love and the stuff that I'm really proud of or whatever. It just so happens to be schlocky, gory stuff.
God bless you.
Yeah, so.
You've done a wonderful thing.
Well, thank you. Yes. Thank you.
Now, you brought up Spider-Man.
Yes.
Now, Spider-Man, we all should consider a big bug movie.
That's certainly a human bug.
It's funny, Matt.
That's true.
I did not put that on my list.
Is that right?
Yeah, because I think of him as a human and not as a big bug.
But just because he
looks human and he thinks human, he has all these bug abilities.
Mm-hmm. Especially in the Sam Raimi ones because he has the biological, physical shooting away from his...
I prefer.
Yeah.
Oh, the Raimi ones are the best. Yeah.
I prefer Homecoming with caveats. I prefer the organic web shooter.
Yeah, they went too far, I think, in Homecoming with making it all the Stark technology.
It's like
I like the movie a lot, but it's too much like Iron Man.
The way he's
talking to his suit and all that.
The original
Peter Parker was never that beholden to Tony Stark.
He's
a kid.
Yeah.
We had Dana DiLorenzo and Ray Santiago from Ash vs. Evil Dead on our episode once, and we talked a lot about Sam Raimi, and I mentioned how thrilled I was when I saw his version of Spider-Man. How it's funny. Here's this guy who was actually from this first Evil Dead, schlocky horror film director, but he, like you said, this is a guy who was passionate and loved this stuff and put everything he could.
Right.
And every film that he did as he grew as a filmmaker, finally you get to this huge, big budget film. And he did a phenomenal job. And it is my favorite Spider-Man, that first one. And when you see Spider-Man towards the end swinging through the cities, I'd have to agree. Right up to the American flag. And I love the whole thing about how it's the biological web. Yeah. That's how I think Spider-Man should be.
It makes more sense.
Well, it's more believable, too, if you don't have Tony Stark in the picture, that it wouldn't be like a teenager or a high schooler that could create technology that it's more realistic that he can do that physically.
Even in the original comic book, it was strange that, like, okay, I've got all these powers as a spider, but I still have to create this completely new technology that'll allow me to have a web shooter.
No, give
him everything right from the beginning.
Absolutely.
Raimi's my hero, and he always has been. You know,
Mine too.
Yeah, and it was always kind of like, my inspiration and my aspiration to, like, see someone that came from those kind of schlocky roots to become this huge A-list director in Hollywood. And one of the joys of my life, one of the highlights of my life thus far was Sam Raimi saw both Tales of Halloween and Big Ass Spider.
And
met with me told me how much he liked the stuff and what a fan he was.
That's awesome.
Oh my god. Yeah, no, it was one of those like I could die now. I'm okay. Yeah.
I met him once at a convention and he was so nice.
Yeah, he's lovely. Yeah.
And I remember it was at the Shrine Auditorium. Wow. And it was for Spider-Man.
Okay.
But I had this Evil Dead poster that I've been trying to get him to sign forever. Evil Dead 2. This beautiful British quad.
My favorite movie. Yeah. Raiders of the Lost Ark and that are my two favorite films.
So love that movie.
Yeah.
And we're waiting in line, and I'm at, like, the end of the line. But it was a huge line. So it's like about five more people, and the Shrine security comes in there and goes, nope, that's it, we're done. And we could see Sam, and we're like, hey, Sam, come on. And he goes, oh, no, you guys are getting autographs, too.
Oh,
yeah,
nice.
Everybody in line, I'm going to stay here till everybody gets their thing signed.
Right, right.
And so then the Shrine people just kind of went, and I yelled at him, and I said, Sam, you're the best. And he goes, there's none better.
No, he was great.
He was great.
Yeah, I mean, I've gotten to meet him a handful of times, but this was the only time I've ever gotten to meet him in a meaningful way.
Right.
Growing up in Pasadena, they would always have test screenings of movies and stuff. And when I was in college and stuff, I would always like to go because A, it was a free movie, and B, it was kind of educational to see that. And I got to meet the coolest people. I went to a screening of People Under the Stairs. So Wes Craven was there.
Nice.
And also New Nightmare as well.
I love that movie. Nightmare.
Yeah, and then every time there was a Raimi movie, so like Quick and the Dead, Army of Darkness, I would always get the passes, and I'd always go, gush over
That's
Raimi.
Great.
Now again, he would remember that, of course. I mean, millions of people have gushed over, but that was, to me, a very special thing. The most amazing one for me, and it's one of those ones I wish I could go back in time and do it differently, and I still don't know what I would have done, was I got to the test screening for a little-known movie called The Frighteners.
Yes. Peter Jackson.
Yes, and I
Jeffrey Combs.
I was absolutely
Michael J. Fox.
I was a big fan of all of those people. and a massive fan of Dead Alive and Bad Taste at that time. And of course here at that point nobody knew who he was.
Oh no.
And so I came out and I saw this very nervous Peter Jackson there, and I wanted to go up to him, but he was standing right next to Danny Elfman, who was, if Raimi is my hero, Danny Elfman is certainly on par, or maybe even above, because Oingo Boingo was my favorite band, my favorite composer. So he's standing next to my hero. Okay, so now I'm like, oh my god, Peter Jackson, Danny Elfman are right there. And then I look over next to them, and it's Robert Zemeckis.
Oh. Wow.
Oh, and I couldn't. I still don't know. What do you do? I'm your biggest fan, and I love Back to the Future so much. I just couldn't.
You could have said, I'm the director of Big Ass Spider.
Well, at that time, I was just a dopey teenager,
That's awesome, though.
I completely understand that, because it's one of those things that you're just going to be that guy.
Well, but
you're going to walk up and you're going to be, hi,
but
I love you.
At the time, Peter Jackson was nobody. You could tell he was very nervous.
Yeah.
I mean, because the movie didn't do that well.
No.
And I don't think people got it. I don't think it was a successful test screen.
No, it wasn't. No.
No.
So I'm sure he would have appreciated going, hey, man, I'm a big fan and I really love your stuff, but it was just daunted by everybody else.
I'm wary of that kind of situation. Because of what could happen if it goes wrong. You know what I mean? I'm nervous about it.
Matt and I, we've had this conversation.
Yeah, I'd rather not have the experience.
Right.
And
sure.
And have
your
I still like them.
Shattered.
Yeah.
Jerry Goldsmith was someone I worshipped growing up, and I saw him at a restaurant. I was having lunch, and he was having lunch with a person who was even older, who I thought, okay, this must be another composer. But from what I heard about Goldsmith, he could be really crabby
with fans.
So you sent him over some pudding and Metamucil.
I didn't go to him. I didn't knock over to him. And sometimes I regret it. But
I know. I mean, that's the thing. It's like,
I would much rather have it be a situation where it's a party at least.
Yes,
where,
of course. Yes, the cold open is very difficult, especially going up as a fanboy. I've always heard actually really, really frightening stories about De Palma.
Oh, really?
Really?
Yeah. I heard some of that. And I can't believe people would be this way, but, supposedly this is true. Someone saw De Palma at a Starbucks or something like that, and he's like, Mr. De Palma, I'm a huge fan. He's like, yeah, get the fuck out of my way.
Wow.
But
I've heard some bad stories about this Sinatra fellow. He seems to be.
Was he unapproachable Sinatra?
He was
supposed
to be a piece of work, that
yes.
man.
But, well, this is great talking about celebrities and celebrity encounters.
But there are no giant bugs in here.
Well, I just wanted to say, we had talked about what was the first monster film or something that you saw, and I've talked about this on another show. I just wanted to share with you, Mike, because you're a big monster fan.
Uh-huh.
Actually, the first monster movie that I remember seeing actually fits with this title, because it was actually The Black Scorpion.
Oh, nice. Okay.
And the funny thing about it is, it's funny. I talked with you guys about this with so much passion, and I actually, it's been a while, but I watched it all the way through. And, the funny thing is, it's not the best of the big insect movies, okay? Uh-huh. Big bug movies. Now, this is a film that the big thing about it was Willis O'Brien, who did special effects for King Kong, did the spider, the scorpion effects. Oh, my God, this is great. But it's one of these films that when you watch it, it takes a while. I mean, you have all the relationships and just the stuff. I mean, they don't even tease you with a scorpion at the beginning. I mean, it takes a while to get to that point. But
when it comes, it's wonderful.
When it comes. But what's funny is, as a kid, Mike, as a kid, what was happening is my cousins were over at the house, and we were playing up above in the kitchen area, and down in the living room, my older brothers were watching The Black Scorpion, and I happened to look at this one particular time, and I happened to see the scene where there's the guy climbing up on the telephone pole, and the scorpion attacks him. Mike, this image is like burned into my brain. Sure, I was about 4 years old. I remember being captivated, and my brothers turned to me because I was standing there, and they go, get out of here. This is too scary. I mean, they were very mean. They were always like, get out of here. You don't want to watch this. And I was like, oh, it's like the forbidden thing. I've got to see it. You know? And trying to, like, peek. And the funny thing is, from that point, you have a lot of scorpion stuff that happens.
Yeah, and there's also a lot of other bugs down that cavern.
Yes.
And,
you know, did you have a lot of spider magazines hidden under your pillow?
No, this is scorpion. But Sean, see, the funny thing is, like, a lot of people have brought up, there's this famous King Kong spider sequence. Was it filmed? Was it not filmed? No one really knows.
Right.
But in this movie, The Black Scorpion, that Willis O'Brien did,
kind of similar.
It's like a centipede type creature.
Worms
with little,
and scorpions.
And some people suggested this was actually one of the creatures that was never used.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah.
Well,
but
from what I've heard from that story, though, it was filmed, the stop motion animation of the giant spider and other creatures in that cavern that Kong knocks over.
Yeah.
He shakes them off the log. They all fall down, and some of them survive, and then they get attacked by the spider and other creatures. What I had read was that it was filmed, and at some early test screenings, it was in there, and it was too much.
Too much.
And it also kind of took away a little bit from the moment, because, you know, Kong was trying to get Bruce Cabot or whatever.
Okay.
So, like, a few select people kind of saw it at these test screens, but then he had taken
see,
out.
Okay, wow. Now I've read that same story. Now, I don't think it's a definite. It's
okay, right.
This was suspected. It's not a documented thing.
Okay.
What my belief is that the plan was always, and it was in the script, to do this in King Kong.
Right.
But to do the animation takes so much time. And here's
that
the reason why the argument doesn't make much sense. Let's say they did it, they showed it, and they said, oh, it takes off too much time, and then they take it out. But you see, when they showed King Kong the whole film, they felt that it was short. We needed to make it another reel. So they added King Kong attacking the train. So you remember when he's in New York City, that wasn't in the original script. They added that to make the film longer. So in a way, it doesn't make sense that we're going to take out a scene which makes it longer, and then it's like, oh, now we have to add another Kong. You know what I'm saying? But my belief is that the creatures were created. It was never animated.
The models are made, right.
And then there's another story that says, Miriam C. Cooper was famous for taking footage and burning it. It's like, again, I just don't seem that to be very likely. But getting back to the Black Scorpion, you know, what's interesting about it is you have the director is Edward Ludwig, who actually went on to do a lot of TV. Like, he did Bonanza and The Texan. This was big, like, in the 60s
and 70s.
Known
for all the big bugs
in
that film.
But you have
TV shows.
Are big in Texas.
You have Richard Denning. Richard Denning, who is from Creature from the Black Lagoon.
Maricordae
and Carlos Rivas, who did a lot of, like, Daniel Boone, Tarzan, you know, from the 60s and stuff. Again, when these guys all get together, there's a lot of talk.
Yeah.
It's like you want to get to the scorpions.
Well, what's nice, too, is about that movie, though, is, like, we're talking about them was, like, giant mechanical puppets, you know, so was the Deadly Mantis.
Yeah.
Tarantula was a real tarantula.
Yeah.
So this was your classic stop-motion animation.
And the funny thing is,
couple puppets.
Yes.
Close-up
of the face. And the funny thing is, when you look at the animation, it's terrific.
It is.
And it's really great. And they also did a trick. There were some, I believe, that they used when they were doing the animation. Sean, they used two cameras. The idea was you're shooting the same scene from two perspectives, so you can show both footage. And it's, in other words, it's like you're saving time,
that's a good idea.
And the weird thing is, the whole film, it's not really consistent. You have this great stop motion animation, but then there's also this superimposition of, and it looks very cheap.
And the big close up of the face was kind of goofy looking. It didn't match.
It's funny. Yeah. I go back and forth on whether I hate it or like it.
It's like drooling a lot.
At this particular point in time, I love it.
I'm with you, Matt. And look, I don't want to. We talked about some films. I don't want listeners to say, "Oh, Larry says it's the greatest film." It has its moments.
Yeah,
okay?
But if you're a monster fan, it's you'll
a good
like
ride.
It.
It's worth checking out.
But there is something special about this film that I wanted to talk about. You know, okay, fun film. You know, they slab chunks of beef that put on these jeeps to get the scorpions to follow them into the
to
big
lure
town.
The flesh-eating scorpions.
Flesh-eating scorpions. It's great, but. On the DVD, there is, I know, in our day of Blu-rays, there's this great DVD that came out of The Black Scorpion. And the interesting thing, and a lot of people don't know, is there's kind of an unsung hero in the film The Black Scorpion. We all know Willis O'Brien, the creator of the animation for King Kong, and he did Mighty Joe Young. But we know now that a young Ray Harryhausen, did about 80% of the stop motion in Mighty Joe Young. Willis O'Brien, as he was getting older, didn't do as much. It's the same thing with The Black Scorpion. He did some animation, but not all of it. Some of it was done by a guy, his apprentice away, called Pete Peterson. And Pete Peterson is kind of like the unsung hero. On this DVD, which is really, really cool, there's a special segment, which is when Pete Peterson passed away, there was a trunk of a bunch of stuff that he had and was saving for some unknown reason at a friend's house. And when the trunk was looked into, there was a reel of special test stop motion animation test footage that he had done. And what was cool is this test footage, one of the pieces was for a thing called the Las Vegas Monster, and the other one was called the Beetlemen. On this DVD, they actually show the footage that he did.
Oh, I saw that.
And what's kind of cool about it is so he would do stop motion animation during the day, and then he had a little studio at home, and then he would use some of the props or some of the set pieces to do his own animation.
That's cool. It's fun stuff.
And it's really, really cool. And I think it's so neat. I believe that when it was found out that there was this trunk it existed, I think Dennis Muren and a bunch of other famous people got together to try to put this stuff out to get people to see it. And so it's really kind of cool. It is cool. And I just felt like oh, Pete Peterson, he never actually had got something to do single handedly.
Never had his day in the sun. Yeah. Yeah.
Going back to King Kong, and I believe this is one of the bonus features that's on the Peter Jackson King Kong.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, I think I know where you're going with this.
Is that he went back and shot his own footage of the insects in the valley sequence.
The spider sequence. He created it. But according to the script.
The script. Right. Like shot for everything.
Shot
is,
for shot.
Is to be as loyal as they possibly could to the original script and right down to how they made the armatures.
That's the amazing stuff, Matt, is that they actually made all the creatures how they would made it back in the 30s. Yeah. So it was with cotton. And the funny thing is they're interviewing these guys who are making this, and they go, man, I don't know how these guys did it. They were bitching about how difficult. They weren't using the modern technology. They were using, and it makes you realize the guys back in the 30s.
The ingenuity.
Oh, my God. It makes it that much more amazing.
It is. Yeah. It's great. And the final version that they shoot is so effective and so great, right down to the fact that they even try to get extras that look like the people in the original movie. And I don't think I've seen them do this yet, and if you guys have, please tell me, but putting that sequence into King Kong would be really interesting to see.
Well, they do, and Peter Jackson is very clear. He says this is his interpretation. He didn't want to use it as thing where, here's studio, you take it and use it. So he shows the sequence. What's kind of cool is some of the extras they used were actual animators that did the animation. In fact, there's a scene, one of the animators who's animating a sailor getting eaten, he's animating himself getting eaten, which is really cool.
It's really good. It's a lot of fun, and
that's a great. You know, I'm so glad he did that.
I don't love the film per se so much, but I love his dedication to the classic King Kong, absolutely. And how much that it does come out of a place of just admiration for the film and everything he did. More so on like the side, you know, like animating the he got Bob Burns' armature,
right? Yeah,
and the remaining armature of like one of the, I forget if it was the pterodactyl or the dinosaur, but he animated them just because he could,
because
I have all this stuff, I have all these people working for me, let me do these things. And I kind of admire that about
it. And I would say that in that remake of King Kong, I think one of the most effective scenes is the insect scene.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah, that's
it's pretty, really that's scary. And to me, it's one of the most scary CGI scenes.
CGI is pretty creepy.
I wish there was a, if they, only they could have had gore. That was the only thing.
Right. That would have really helped.
In a way, it's almost like it's from a you want to put it in a separate movie. Yeah. You know, call it the pit or something, you know, and where you guys have to go through this pit where they encounter all of these millipedes or all these grotesque creatures.
You know, speaking of Kong, and speaking of big ass spiders, one of the most effective moments in Kong Skull Island was that spider.
That was my favorite scene.
And I love that movie. I think that movie's great. I like the movie a lot.
Lots of fun.
That movie's wonderful because it is that very rare type of thing that it's an A-list B movie. Like that movie is a total B movie. And is unapologetic about it.
Right down to the 50s type characters.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Absolutely.
But that the way they introduced that spider is great. And that's the one exception, I think, where I don't know what it is, but even though it was a giant monster, I got creeped out by it. I don't know what it is. Yeah. The design of it, the way it's shot from a, but like, I don't know.
I'm right on board with that. I really liked.
Yeah, that was really good.
I want to go home and watch that now.
It's true. Now, James, I know we've been dominating here. Is there a bug film that
what's your bug film? What bugs you?
What?
Well, we already talked about Tarantula, but talking about the movie that made you a monster fan, for me it was Tarantula. Back when I was six and growing up in New England, on Saturday nights, they debuted a double feature of old black and white Universal films. And they really hyped up the Dracula, the Lugosi, the original. And there were so many commercials for it that I begged my mom to stay up and watch it. And I was 6 years old. And she said yes. So I'm watching the 1930...
We are the greatest parents ever.
We do.
When you're 6 years old, that's a little tough going, the original Lugosi Dracula.
Sure, yeah. When you're six, yes.
But I was wide awake. The movie was over at 1 a.m. I wasn't sure exactly what I was just seeing.
You're 6 years old?
Yeah.
But the second...
We're drinking coffee?
the second...
We're taking Jolt?
I have no idea why I was still awake. Maybe it was just the fact that I was still awake that excited me. But the second feature...
What?
The second feature was Tarantula, and I begged, you know, I was like, oh, can I
stay up to 4 a.m., Mom?
I'm wide awake. Can I watch?
I'm six. I got nothing. I got nothing going tomorrow.
I was allowed to watch Tarantula, and what a difference, because here was a movie that was so much more accessible.
Everything about it, more bombastic and more like
you could
in your face.
For a six-year-old, you could
follow it. And you stayed up the whole movie?
I was up until 2:30.
Oh, my God.
The original Dracula, for as much love as I have for it, it's a little stale. It's a little like a play.
I want to like it, and I love Lugosi, of course, and I love just how iconic the he looks. But it's not.
And the original Mummy is kind of like that too.
Can we agree, though, before we rag on it, it's a product of the time, because we could talk about how much these guys don't like Avatar or something. But look at the time. At the time when Dracula came out, that was a big film.
It was and I give it credit.
And Renfield ate bugs.
He did. They're not big bugs.
That's what I thought you were going with. We can agree the James Whale films are far better. And then the Spanish version. Yeah, the Spanish version.
Hands down.
Yeah.
More atmospheric.
But
better directed.
Yeah.
Easily.
We mentioned briefly Mothra a minute ago, and I want to go back to that because it's 1961 Toho, directed by Ishiro Honda, who had done Godzilla.
Yes.
But... You know, it was kind of a turning point. It was, I think, a pretty significant turning point. And it was not a malevolent monster. Mothra was very benign.
It was like this kind of magical god.
Yeah.
Right. You know.
That natives had to worship.
Right.
And do sacrifice or like make juice or something, right?
Well, I don't know about the juice, but there were these two...
We've all made a little juice in our day.
There were these two little fairy twins called the Shobi Jin, who were played by the Peanuts, a musical duo. And, you know, they always spoke in unison. And one of the amazing things that I always thought was amazing was that Mothra was this massive, oversized moth, and that the fairy twins were tiny. You know, so you had this juxtaposition.
The scale was so different. Yeah. I know, you're right.
Can you imagine being nagged by the Peanuts?
if you were married to him. You know?
Oh, God.
Why don't you take out the garbage?
And they're saying it in unison.
Why don't you get a job? Mother is very angry.
Okay, okay.
Mother wants you to get off the couch.
Okay, no, no, no.
Put
no.
down the bong.
Okay, but you give a really good point, because when Mothra is looking down at the humans all dancing and parading and bowing, I mean, they seem small to him, but then the peanuts are like even smaller.
Yeah.
But Mothra's eyes, because Mothra has lots of, it's like those giant eyes that have like millions of eyes. So I'm sure it could probably zoom in on those peanuts.
That is a very good point, though. That for he's so huge.
Yes.
Can he just
how does
knock
he
him
even,
over?
So oh, how does now, he even see
now,
the
wait,
peanuts?
But you say he. You say,
I'm sorry, she.
She. Excuse me.
Is it
usually,
she? Is it officially a she?
Usually it's a she.
I'll go with she. I'll go with
feminine.
She.
Okay. Yeah. But is Mothra, okay, here's a question, though. Mothra is this kind of god from Infant Island, right? It's this creature. Is it officially just a big moth, or is it more? Is it like a kind of ancient creature? You know what I mean, though? I mean, it does look just like a moth.
I think it's just a big moth because it's not immortal. You know, I mean, it does regenerate. It's got to go through the larval stage as a caterpillar,
right.
You know.
So it just happens to be a really, really big moth.
But one thing that's really kind of remarkable about it as a turning point, I would attribute it to the screenwriter. I mean, this is his first effort for a Toho monster movie, and his name was Shinichi Sekizawa. And if you look at how that movie was different than the kaiju movies that preceded it, like Godzilla and Rodan, it had this element of whimsy and fantasy and almost a kind of affection and humor, certainly humor in the characters that the other movies before that didn't have. But the movies after that, especially the ones that were written by him.
That's true.
That's a good point.
Ghidra, yeah. Monster Zero. I mean, the movies that we love from the 60s of the Toho period had a lot to do with his influence, if not his direct writing.
Right, right.
So, just thought that was worth mentioning. It started with Mothra.
That's true.
But it's interesting that you've got the peanuts, who are these tiny little women that come to Tokyo, and instead of using them in the military or doing spy work, showbiz!
Well, I'm going to put you in showbiz!
Well, that's just it. I mean, they're being exploited.
Exploited, Matt. Right.
Sure. You know,
but exploit them for the government.
Right, the army.
The whole thing becomes this kind of caution against exploitation and capitalism,
invading on sacred land.
Yeah,
and, you know,
yeah.
Right.
Now I love Mothra. Mm-hmm. I love Mothra, but when I would see Mothra in those other Godzilla movies, there's Godzilla versus the Thing.
Yeah,
where he's fighting Mothra.
Yeah,
let me guess. Godzilla's gonna win.
No. See, Matt. This is what James is talking about.
Well, he doesn't lose.
No. Here's the thing. Mothra is kind of old, and Mothra's actually kicking Godzilla's ass. You know?
Really?
Yes. But what happens is Mothra laid these just giant egg. You know, and it's like, oh gosh, I'm kind of weak, and it's actually kind of beating up on Godzilla. But it's like now Mothra goes, oh, I'm so tired. I can't go on any further, and I guess I'm gonna die now. And so what happens is you have this tragic moment where Mothra gave it his all and actually was kicking Godzilla's butt, and then has to give up, and then you get the best part. The best part. Well, what happens?
Spoiler.
Yes. You could,
no, spoil it.
The egg. The special egg hatches. And what comes out of it, Mike? Not one, but two.
Two Martha larvae.
Okay. And that's where it loses me.
No.
Because it's like, okay, Mothra might have had a chance. But it's like I'll show you. I'll give birth to two infants.
But it bites his tail and it stings. And
the end of that movie should have been foot on egg, foot on caterpillar.
No. Look.
Credits roll.
See, you guys are thinking, oh, little furry caterpillar.
What's the Japanese word for splat?
Listen, little furry caterpillar, you can just... But see, here's the thing. When you look at those giant caterpillars, they're not just little furry caterpillar. They're a big, tough, leathery.
Yeah, that's
you know,
they are, yeah.
Larva. They're larva. Yeah. And
Mike, chain belt.
They can spit out. They spit out this web stuff. And it's like when you're talking about web.
Wow.
No. So
that almost got in my eye.
But you see, it's like here's Matt. Oh, web stuff. Oh, that's not gonna hurt me. It's sticky. It puts you in kind of like a cocoon yourself.
I have atomic
and there's
breath,
dude. It's not just one. It's two of these.
Oh, two. One caterpillar could suddenly rush behind behind me.
Now, here's the thing, and we've talked about this on another show.
It doesn't really work. No, come on.
Yes, no. The very important point. Now, not to give away the ending, but let's just say Godzilla just has enough, and he's like, I'm out of here.
Now, okay. That I could see. Godzilla's okay. Just going, this is just pathetic. Okay, I'm going.
No. So here you have these two Mothra larvas who have worked together as a team. But what happens? There's two. What happens in the later movie? There is only one. What happened? We want to know the missing Mothra larva story. Oh, do they attack each other? Does one kill the other one? There could be only one. Because I wish to be worshipped by the peanuts. You know what I mean? Maybe.
The Cain and Abel, the East of Eden of Mothra movies. No,
that does explain. Going more Highlander. No,
James,
that works.
We talked about this on another show. Don't you remember?
I don't remember, but that does explain why there are never two Mothra adult moths. There's only ever one.
Really? Yeah, there can only be one.
Well, are you right. Excited that they're all coming back? That you've got a new Godzilla. You've
well,
got
yes,
King
yes,
Kong
yes. But you know
Godzilla.
That's right. Why we're just really quickly, really just
Mothra's
really
got a caterpillar in every port.
And along those same lines, another Godzilla film that has another giant bug. Bear with me,
of course.
From 76 Godzilla versus Megalon.
Yeah,
Megalon is a giant beetle. Megalon is a giant beetle.
He's not just a regular cockroach, though.
No, but
he's
you a, say
but
not
he is a type of bug.
He is a type. Okay. Oh, wait, are you going to deny? Me that he's
deny you?
Deny me that he's not a giant.
Wow. We've reached a new level here. On Monster Party.
I don't consider Megalon a classic, regular, oversized bug. He's a kaiju. He is part his bug. He has insect-like qualities, but he shoots fireballs. He stands upright.
That's a bug.
He has drill hands. How is that a regular bug?
He has to put his hands together to drill. Oh, what? And yes. Play. And the praying mantis doesn't, you know, use his little. No. Okay. Arms.
So speaks Larry Strothe, superstar.
Now, Son of Godzilla yeah. Has Kamacharis, which is a giant praying mantis.
Right.
A regular praying mantis, very similar to the
cool.
To the
Mike,
deadly.
You know cool. This, Mike,
Spiga,
right?
Spiga, giant
right?
Spider.
I don't know them as well as you do. I got to be honest.
All right. Yeah. But just keep quiet.
And
listen.
A giant spider. Okay. So Spiga, also known as Kumonga.
Yes.
From Son of Godzilla, and Kamacharis, the praying mantis.
Praying mantis. Yes.
Those are classic giant oversized bugs.
Yes.
But if they shrunk them down, it would look like a regular bug.
Okay.
But they look
megalon,
cool, though.
If you saw a little megalon, what the fuck is that thing?
Dude, it's like a mutant bug. It's like a mutant bug.
Okay, if that counts, okay.
If you take the bug and you throw like some nuclear stuff at it, don't you think it's going to change?
Well, megalon was like a god from Cetopia or something.
Yes,
it was like from an underground Atlantis.
But he's still
Atlantis
bug-like.
Type.
He's still bug-like.
I know, he's definitely bug-like, yeah. I
Lord,
agree.
Lord Jesus, calm down.
Also, another bug, though, I would say, is the not megalon, but meganulon, which is the little insect that Rodan eats.
Right.
And Rodan.
Yes.
That was like a prehistoric bug.
Yeah, it's a prehistoric
about
bug.
About the size of like a car. Yes.
And that was that's a movie that it's funny because I, for years, sort of put Rodan in the back of my mind as kind of a lesser effort because I.
Yeah.
All I remember as a kid is that it's a bird flapping its wings and it just ruins cities that way. Like, okay, great. But I rewatched that movie and it's actually the way that the story unfolds is really captivating.
Yeah.
And that if you didn't know anything about the title character, even the beginning with the bugs is creepy and spooky.
Yeah, it's really cool.
And it's a mystery and you're trying to figure out what the hell is going on here.
Yeah, you
got
to go in the cave. And
that movie it has a tragic ending too.
Yeah,
it does.
Really sad watching both
and
the two Rodans in their death throes.
Spoiler alert.
Over that volcano.
Yeah, no, they come back.
Sad. I will say
they do come back.
Yeah. There is only one thing that bugs me about that movie.
Bugs you?
No! Write it back. Save the episode.
It's just... I love that movie because it's in beautiful Technicolor. You know, the fire, the explosions.
It's one of the first Toho ones in color.
Yeah,
right?
And then what bugs me is when you get to the end and you have this tragedy, I swear to God, it seems like one of the Rodans, when it decides to end itself, it looks like... He's got two wires and one wire breaks. And he's hanging by one wing.
That's probably
wing.
What it was. And,
and
really
then and
happened.
They because the fire's going up and one wing goes and then
right,
it goes
melted.
And I looked at that and even as a kid I went, Ah,
you know what? Hey,
because
no.
I might the illusion was wrecked for me.
There's one. Look,
I believe
there's a
was...
rule at Toho Studios: no reshoots during volcano scenes.
It just doesn't happen.
Right, right. Yeah,
but they don't have the you know.
But you know what? It's a small thing, Sean. It's a small thing.
No, because the union won't allow it.
It's a good film.
Yeah,
but a couple other 50s ones you got to mention though too is like not a great movie. Again, using real insects was the beginning of the end.
Bert
Gordon.
You know that one?
Giant grasshoppers. Peter Graves fighting giant grasshoppers.
And they're real.
It's kind of famous for being the worst of those movies.
Okay. Yeah,
it's in so many
bad.
Ways.
They actually have picture. Was it? It's a picture, Sean.
It's like a
of a city or a
printed a poster
of a
building,
photograph.
Yeah,
and then they had a grasshopper crawl across it.
I have seen at least the footage. I've seen that scene. Yes, I've never seen the movie, but
Another one that's not that great has its moments, but it's not the greatest. Is Monster from Green Hell?
I know it.
Monster from Green Hell
is giant wasps in the jungle.
I haven't seen this one.
It's limited animation. Another one that takes a long time.
It takes a long time to go. And then when you see the wasp head is pretty cartoonish. It looks like something that would be outside of a funhouse kind of a look.
Yeah, so you guys aren't really recommending this one to me.
Not really. If you want to be a completist, go for it.
Yeah, yeah. A better one is the monster that challenged the world.
That is a good one.
That's the
kind of a mollusk. You know, a giant mollusk.
I thought
mollusk.
It was like a centipede kind of thing.
Well, it's a kind of sea-based mollusk thing. But really great mechanical
he knows his mollusk.
Effects. Yeah. All right, but another kind of like them. It's like a live-action puppet, oversized and really good.
Very
really
effective.
Scary.
That one is
actually.
A really,
yeah,
really,
really
great,
good, really good film. Yeah.
Any love
one.
For Mysterious Island? I mean, that's
of course.
That's got some giant bees.
The bee scene is, I think, probably my favorite.
Yeah,
he's like putting them in when he's like. Adding
yeah,
he's sealing them in the honeycomb,
and it's funny because a lot of people. It's funny how you said that because a lot of people say, "Oh, when the bees come," and the weird thing is, there's only one bee, but
totally.
You hear multiple bees,
and actually.
That sequence when you have these two characters who hide in a honeycomb, thinking, "Okay, I'm going to stay away from the bee," and the bee is putting its little honey wax thing over
and
it.
Seal
them
so
up.
Great. The
and
detail,
and it's cool.
It's really neat.
I enjoy the giant chicken too, but I realize it's not a bug. So
no,
the crab.
You know,
the crab's close enough. Yeah.
Okay, Mr. Smarty Pants. Just really quickly,
the squid is the one.
No,
I really
no, no.
Enjoy.
We're talking big bugs. So, do you know what other Harryhausen film has a giant insect in it?
Oh, yes, I do. Yeah,
okay.
I do, as a matter of fact.
Okay.
It's on my list.
Okay, two.
Clash of the Titans.
That's one.
It's a giant scorpion.
Scorpions,
which are formed from
beautiful.
Medusa's blood,
yes.
right?
Yep. Yes, beautiful.
And, Calabos cuts open, so it bleeds in the ground,
and the scorpions
grow. It's a great sequence.
Great
Perseus
scorpions.
Fighting the scorpions.
Yeah, that is cool.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Is there another one? What is it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I want... Come on.
An official bug. Give me
Sinbad and the Eye of the Tiger. If you remember, it's a giant wasp that grows. Do you remember that?
Oh yeah,
that's
you're
right.
Right.
It's
okay.
It's one of those things where it's really not well known.
I forgot about that too.
When we think about that, we think of the giant battle between the tiger and stuff, and people forget there's that smaller sequence. It's not a huge sequence, but
you're missing a couple more.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
First Men in the Moon.
That's on my list.
Everyone on the planet is an insect.
They're ant.
That's
men,
true.
Ant-like creatures, and also
then the giant
and then the giant moon,
the moon caterpillar,
which is a caterpillar. And I love that animation.
Yeah, cool looking, yeah.
Insects really work well with stop motion.
Yeah, they do. You're right. It's like just a texture, you know, and the looks of them.
What's cool about that film? It's based on a story by H.G. Wells, directed by Nathan Duran, and it has the wonderful Walter Jeffries, who was in Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. And one of your favorites.
Also known for Big Bugs.
Yeah.
Lionel Jeffries?
Lionel Jeffries, yes. Mm. Yes.
How about some more modern ones?
There's this crazy one that I saw from Japan. I wish it was better. It's one of Takashi Miike's latest films.
Okay.
I believe it's called Terraformers.
Don't know this.
And it's an interesting concept. It's based on a manga, but the movie's not great, but it's such a cool idea. They send, to test if Mars is inhabitable. I think it's Mars. They send cockroaches, right? And then years later, this group, they've like put a base up there. Now no one has heard from them. They go up there, and now the cockroaches have evolved into big cockroach creatures.
Oh, I didn't know this one.
And then, I wish it was
better. Are they CGI?
But, They're CGI.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
But the way that the crew can combat them is that they have these different insect serums. So they can kind of put a wasp serum in them, and then they turn into a mutant wasp guy.
That's cool.
And then they go and fight the roaches. Now it's very repetitive. It's all right, let's try a bee. Let's try a mantis.
As a fan of the Kamen Rider series.
Oh,
in Japan,
which
every single Kamen Rider is basically a takeoff of some sort of either grasshopper or insect, and they all have the big insect eyes.
Right,
and
it's true. It's a very common thing.
And then a lot of their villains are also weird man spiders.
Yeah,
and
that's always why I thought the one Marvel superhero character that they took to was Spider-Man. Because Spider-Man already has that kind of big insect.
He has that look.
Ultraman look.
That's Sean. I never thought about
that. Yeah.
That Japanese Spider-Man, if you haven't seen that, that's a good time.
Oh, my God. It's insane.
I don't know if I have.
Yeah. It was a TV series in the 70s.
Crazy.
It is crazy. And the origin of Spider-Man is more like the Green Lantern.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where an alien lands and gives Peter Parker, or whatever that translates into in Japanese,
right?
The powers of Spider-Man. But along with the powers of being this human spider, he also gets a giant robot, of course.
Of course, one does.
Spaceship.
Okay.
And so, he does his Spider-Man stuff. He fights ninja, shocker, Kamen Rider type villains. But when things get too out of hand, get in the spaceship, get in the giant robot.
Right.
Because one of those guys is going to grow into a giant monster.
Right.
He has to battle
big
the robot.
Explosions.
A lot of explosions. And the real super basic special effects that they use for the climbing the walls are so bad that they almost make you happy. That's what I love about a lot of these Japanese tokusatsu series is that they just throw everything into every episode.
Right.
And it doesn't matter if we have the money, fuck it. Glue some stuff onto this sack and then we'll have a little tiny city and we'll have a fight and there'll be a robot.
Because that's they're making it for kids. Nobody's watching. Their kids aren't discriminating. Let's just do it. Don't not put too much thought into it.
Right.
Well, there was a film that was made not for kids. It was a big budget, more modern. And we're talking about, it's like the big bug in the room. Mm-hmm. I know Matt has definite feelings about this film, but it's from 1997, Starship Troopers.
Yes.
I mean, say what you want about it, whether you like it or hate it. The bugs in Starship Troopers.
Oh, bugs are great.
I think are just fantastic.
I love that.
And they're like alien bugs. They're like alien species.
I think that movie is brilliant.
The movie is pretty amazing.
So it's directed by Paul Verhoeven. And a lot of people said, the funny thing is I did a little research because I wanted to get to the backstory of it. It's based on a story by Robert Heinlein.
Yeah.
But what I didn't realize is, you and I were having a conversation about, well, Larry, it's like fascism, But that wasn't in Heinlein's original story.
I think that was Verhoeven's take.
That was to parody.
Which is interesting because
Robert Heinlein, when you look at his stuff, he's a guy who did a lot of classic 1940s, 1950s space operas, and it's science fiction. He was a science fiction writer, but his story was more uplifting, I think, than what Paul Verhoeven did.
When you first start watching that movie, you think, oh my God, this is the worst movie in the world.
First time seeing it in the theater, what is this?
The acting's not that great. But then as the film progresses, you kind of get on board I get it. And then when they start throwing in the commercials from the propaganda and this weird dystopian future, I get it. The humans are the bad guys.
Right. It's a very cynical movie.
So for listeners who are not familiar with it, because it's from 97, just imagine it takes place on Earth in the future, okay? And Earth is more like a militaristic type world, and where to belong or to become a part
to
of a citizen.
To be a citizen, you have to join the military.
Which is actually, some countries do this, where you have to do military service,
okay?
So Earth had been attacked, or was it...
Or we so attacked. We're told.
So we're told by this... alien beings, which appear to be these giant insects. So our duty now is to come together as a country to get our military stuff, and we're going to go and attack these giant evil bugs out there. Yeah.
But as the movie progresses, you get more and more hints
yes.
of the fact that maybe we started this war.
Exactly.
Maybe we
attacked
them. They're really just defending themselves.
So, yeah. So it follows the story with Casper Van Dien, Denise Richards, Neil Patrick Harris, who are all these friends who, you know, they're all very young and they have these ideas.
They're all very, like, optimistic about this.
Positive, yeah. And they all go into the military and they go through these different paths, and you get to a point where they end up being very experienced and they're very different towards the end.
Right. Yeah, no, it's a good film. It is it's a very subversive movie.
Yes, and CGI works very well in that movie.
In this case, it works pretty good.
It's done both in daytime and nighttime. What's really cool is actually we've had a couple guests on the show. We had Greg Travis, who was on our show, who was in the movie.
Uh-huh.
And
he's the reporter.
Yeah, okay, all right.
And what's cool is we actually had Rick Overton on, who actually told the story about how they actually had Greg in the mandibles being torn apart, and I think his impression was great. Well, Verhoeven goes, "Shake him hard, I want to see his legs flop around."
I can see that.
And so it's really cool to get those two stories from these guys. And it's graphic, it's violent, and when you see these bugs attack, I mean, it's like they go all out. And understand, listeners, I'm not saying, hey, this is the greatest film, but it's one of those films that...
It's a great movie.
It's got stuff. I think RoboCop's a great movie. I think Total Recall's a great movie. I think this
Total
is a movie
Recall.
With... yeah, Total Recall's great.
Matt's not a fan.
I'm not on board.
It's okay. Total Recall, really?
Keep going.
Anyway, I love elements of Starship Troopers. I don't love it as a whole. There's too many weird things about it for me. I mean, you know, I partially is the acting. There's this weird thing that Verhoeven at some point started to hate his characters. Starship Troopers is actually kind of the beginning of that. I think it was Showgirls and that he just started to
good
like,
double feature, by the
yeah,
way.
Yeah, there's no one you really root for. Everyone's kind of an asshole or an idiot. Hollow Man being the epitome of it. I think we can all agree
that's terrible.
But you're right. That movie, no, just for a second, Hollow Man, everybody in that movie is so despicable.
Absolutely.
You take what's his face? Kevin Bacon's character.
Yeah, it's a rapist.
He's already a horrible person. Then when he's coming invisible, he's even worse. Who do you just root for?
Right? Absolutely. And so I believe Starship Troopers is kind of the beginning of that weird thing that he did. Now
he just hates humanity.
I haven't seen some of his later films, the last 5 years, which I hear are great. He did Black Book and L. I have not seen those, but I've heard raves about them. So I've heard he's kind of doing kind of smaller films, but I hear they're excellent.
Okay.
I've heard great things about.
Supposedly he's like a maniac, though, the guy.
Yeah, I'm sure he is, you know. Right. But that's the thing, is that there was a point of where Verhoeven to me was like untouchable. Starship Troopers is a bit of a mixed bag for me.
Yeah.
Right.
But it's got, you know, probably the best cow death on cinematic history. the gore is top notch. I'm a big fan of violence.
Alien stuff, and the alien
stuff is all fantastic. But at the same thing, I will also give it credit that it is working on several layers.
Which you don't expect for a big budget, giant bug movie.
It's not a thing that you just take at face value. There's definitely more.
Yes, there are layers happening there that I'm sure most of the people that went to see it
did not understand or like. Myself included. It's taken a while to appreciate I still don't fully appreciate the movie 100%, but I appreciate that there is some depth to it, and that there's some layers that are kind of hidden about it.
Right.
By the time that you get to Neil Patrick Harris
at the end,
turning into a full SS,
when he's got a full-on SS coat. By that point, we were all on board with like, oh,
and
humans are the
bad
guys.
And he has this one line that he says about the bug that
the
he senses.
Bug?
Yeah. And at that line, and people cheer. Matt's right. It's like I hated the humans.
Yeah, I was.
This was not the way I thought it was gonna go.
Now the big penis bug at the end is all. I felt sorry for it being dragged out.
And it was not an accident that the last alien that you see that he's commenting on looks almost cuddly compared to the rest of the
right. And also kind of terrified, I think, with the eyes. I felt sad, and I felt guilty, you know, because I thought it was like, hey, let's go get these bugs kind of thing. Maybe that was the intent all the time. But anyway, it's like big budget. I mean, it's a big budget film.
Well, this is terrible acting in it,
but there's some good people in it, though.
What's interesting, though, is that as it goes on, I started to go, oh, I see. This is the society if we were all wiped out.
Yeah. Right.
It's only the square jawed, super attractive,
yeah.
you know,
right,
you know, traditionally handsome and beautiful people.
Far right.
yeah. Can yeah. Like, yeah however.
Like,
yeah.
Kind of well, like yeah. real life.
Yeah.
yeah. if we're talking about the '90s too, you had a couple pretty significant big bug movies. Tremors, of course.
Sure, that's a great one. Yeah, yeah.
Great movie. Pretty solid franchise, actually.
So,
a lot of the sequels are really
Tremors,
good.
Tremors, though? You, those, you
well,
consider
they're,
them
they're worms. Well, we, yeah, we talked worms. About they're, being...
Okay,
you
I'll
know,
go along
no,
with
no,
that.
No,
yeah.
I'm, okay, I'm with you. I didn't
you're
put
big.
That on my, yeah.
Okay.
If you'll give me Megalon, I'll give you...
Okay.
Okay, okay, fine.
All right. Deal. All right. Yeah.
We had...
you guys need to be in the Mideast. Clear up that old mess in minutes.
Another kind of fun one was Ticks.
Ticks is one of the greatest movies ever.
Really
come on.
Yeah.
Amy Dolan's, yes.
Oh, my
the
God.
Lovely Amy Dolan's, yes. I love her.
Yeah.
And Clint Howard is in it, I think.
The
right?
lovely Clint Howard, yeah. yes.
Well, can I throw one from the 90s?
well, wait a minute. We got to still stay on Ticks a little bit.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Because,
yes, Ticks.
What's his face from the Fresh Prince?
Will Smith?
No, the other guy.
Alfonso,
his sidekick.
Alfonso Ribeiro?
Yeah.
Yeah, Rosalind
he's,
Allen.
He's like
Seth
a,
Green's in
he's
it.
A thug in that movie.
oh, that is
yeah.
funny. Yeah.
That's
yeah.
great.
Peter
I mean,
Scolari is in
yeah.
it.
Wow.
Yeah, that's a fun one.
The effects in that thing
effects are great.
Are top notch.
And again, kind of like you're saying, Helen, Big Ass Spider and these other films where funny situations and funny characters, but the horror of the monsters are treated
right.
straight.
Yeah, yes.
Totally.
Yeah.
Now, I haven't seen this one. Is it T-I-C-K-S?
Yes.
Yeah. yeah.
Ticks.
It's
yeah.
a fun
you're,
one. Yeah.
You're recommending this.
Absolutely.
It's a fun
it's really
movie.
Fun.
Yeah.
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 Let's Tony Randall right. directed it. Yeah, it's really good. There's a couple like mosquito movies around the same time. There was Skeeter, and there was Mosquito,
which I believe,
and my favorite,
Gunnar Hansen from
yes,
Texas
Gunnar
Chainsaw
Hansen. That was a pretty fun one actually.
Some amazingly terrible effects, but you know,
yeah,
but my favorite title. Mansquito.
Fantastic. You're going on that right. one. Now, Mansquito is pretty enjoyable, actually, because that's got a little bit like Cronenberg Fly kind of action
yes.
going. It's a little
yeah.
kind of body horror.
Yeah.
Speaking of Cronenberg.
Speaking of giant bugs.
The cockroach typewriter from Naked Lunch.
That's
sure.
on my
list. Well, and the mugwump.
And the mugwump.
I would say
true.
That's an insect.
Yeah, I guess it's
yeah,
an
Naked
insect.
Lunch
humanoid insect thing.
Yeah.
Right, totally.
You've seen Naked Lunch.
I had it on my list.
Yeah.
Mimic.
Mimic?
I actually
yeah,
enjoy
yes.
Mimic.
You know,
I
like
can't Guillermo's very hard on it, but like I actually think it's out of a pretty cool movie.
Yeah, I love the idea.
I have not seen he released a director's cut
yeah,
that I have
I've
not
seen,
oh, really?
Seen
that I would like to see. Because that was a movie that I felt was where you were describing this Japanese movie.
Uh-huh.
I felt like the premise of that film is so strong, but the execution more the plot, the way the plot unravels. Is what kind of let me down a little bit in that movie.
Right, right.
What I love, I mean, the idea that you have an insect that is able to
camouflage itself,
disguise
yeah,
itself
totally,
to
yeah.
look like a man in
that's
a cloak.
That's awesome. Yeah.
So cool.
There's cool stuff. It's a cool looking movie. The,
there
the
is cool stuff.
Cool, you know, I enjoy yeah. it. I mean, you know, he hates it because, and he was, and to his credit, he was the first person to go out against Harvey Weinstein and call him a scumbag because
yeah.
he hated the experience and he would always tell people. I mean, he was very vocal about, like, don't ever work with the Weinsteins. They're monsters. They're horrible
wow.
people. Yeah.
Wow.
And, you know, they had Robert Rodriguez come in and, like, reshoot. You know, stuff. You know,
oh.
there's like a jump scare with a rat that's kind of infamous ugh. That he absolutely
oh,
hates.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And the stuff. So he hates it because it was just, you know, micromanaged and recut and, you mm-hmm. know, and.
But considering that, I thought it was, yeah.
No, I think there's good stuff.
I do
it.
Like
I mean,
it.
You know,
and the
really,
bug stuff is top notch. I think
yeah,
the bug stuff's
yeah.
great.
I still feel, you know, it's actually a Guillermo movie. There's Guillermo movies that I like less, you know. So
right, right.
You know.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
yeah.
yeah. Going back to the 70s a little bit, we talked about Giant Spider Invasion, of course, which
of
is
course,
the,
yeah.
the VW bug.
VW bug yeah. I love that scene.
And yeah, Burt I. Gordon yeah, came out basically a 1-2 punch, which was Empire of the Ants.
Empire of
and,
the Ants.
And Food of the Gods.
Yeah. yeah.
Food of the Gods had the wasps.
And that was second?
Food of the Gods was actually first. That
first,
was 76,
okay.
and Empire of the Ants was 77.
Well, and the other one I was going to bring up that time... Kingdom of the Spiders. You know.
Oh yeah, not giant bugs.
Not giant bugs. Yes,
yeah.
that is
but
true.
Real
yes.
creepy crawly
yeah.
real bugs.
Yeah.
Which,
I
yeah.
just I feel terrible because you know clearly there was no you know animal association.
Oh my gosh,
out.
That's
I'm
the
so
one thing
you,
about
guys.
That movie.
Yeah.
I always
yeah.
remember you see them
you
being
see them, like, being
squashed.
No,
I felt so bad
yeah.
for them.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah, no, totally. Yeah, there is
right
again with the bugs.
I'm sorry,
but and also I would watch a lot of like Italian monster movies and stuff like that. And there's one called Rats: Night of Terror.
Oh my God, that's a hilarious movie.
It's a hilarious movie. At the end, not giant bugs, but I don't want to spoil it.
Great twist ending.
Best endings ever.
Yes, it is. If you haven't seen it, see it.
But holy shit, those poor rats. And I hate rats. Yeah,
but you're right, though.
Poor rats.
I hate to see any kind of animal in there. That's why I like
they have a look on their face of like, sweet Jesus, please.
Those Italian filmmakers, they
did not give a shit.
Oh my God, you're right. I hate that.
Yeah,
right.
Totally.
But that is a crazy movie, though.
Can I throw out something from 96? You had mentioned the 90s, because and it's like a lot of the stuff we're mentioning is live action stuff. Well, how about this great classic from 1996 called James and the Giant Peach?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Directed
okay.
by Henry Selick. He's the guy who directed Nightmare Before Christmas. This is produced by Tim Burton based on the Roald Dahl book. And what's cool about this story, it follows this little boy who there's this peach that grows outside his house, and the two aunts, the evil aunts, aunts and Sponge, they want to take the peach and destroy it or whatever, but the little boy gets into the peach, and there are these giant insects that live inside the peach. There's a caterpillar, there's a ladybug.
Richard Dreyfuss. David Thewlis.
And there's a great spider. The voice is Susan Sarandon.
Sexy spider.
That's right.
And the funny thing about this is the animation in this, it's almost like it's a step up above A Nightmare Before Christmas, but it's not as well known because Nightmare Before, it has that goth look. But James the Giant Peach is really kind of cool, and the peach is fantastic. But what's really cool is, at the time when it was being made, I had a friend who was an art director named Bill Bowes. And Bill Bowes had worked with me at a special effects studio called Midland Productions outside San Francisco. And he had worked, he was working on James the Giant Peach, and he invited me to come over to check out the sets.
Oh, nice.
So I got to go over, and what was cool about going is I got to see all of these sets of James the Giant Peach, and all the Nightmare Before Christmas stuff was pushed to the side.
Wow.
And it was going to be thrown away.
Oh, my shit.
Really?
Unbelievable. And I was, of course, I couldn't take, I was like, But what was really cool is, as one of the little gifts he gave me when I visited, there was a mold of the spider, one of the faces for the spider he gave me.
So that's great.
Because for that type of animation, they have multiple faces of the spider for their different mouth movements. So I have one of the faces. It's not painted or anything because it was either molded, but still.
That's
the spider
awesome.
Is actually one of my favorite characters.
That's
so
great.
I want, cool. Again, yeah, I want to thank Bill for giving me that amazing tour years and years ago.
That's awesome.
Amazing, Bill's gone on to do all kinds of other great stuff. He's an amazing artist.
Can I throw a movie out there? Blue Monkey? Anyone?
Matt, I don't know.
Yeah, kind of a giant, kind of a mutant, kind of mantis.
Yeah.
Thing, right?
And it's
that's a crazy movie.
Yeah, there's so much going on. There's someone touches a plant.
Yeah,
and
he goes to the hospital.
And he goes to the hospital, and then while they're working on him, they find that he's infested with this larva. And
you never know where it comes from. Really,
it's a lot. It kind of goes all over the place.
Steve Rails back,
but
isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh wow.
But I mean, it hits the ground running.
Yeah, it's a fun one. I think it's a Canadian production. I think.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And then The Nest is pretty fun.
Oh, we've talked about The Nest.
The Nest is cool because it kind of like starts out regular sized cockroaches, but then it gets into kind of like thing territory because they kind of mutant ones. Mm-hmm. I want to throw out too from the 70s a classic Night Gallery episode featuring Patrick O'Neill, and the episode is called A Fear of Spiders.
He's this
snobby kind of like gourmet food critic who's like mean to everybody. There's this kind of lonely hearts neighbor who wants to come hang out with him. He shuns her away.
Yeah.
And he complains to his landlord ever because he's this little spider in his sink.
Yeah, and it keeps crawling out of the sink.
He's washing it down, but every time it crawls out of the sink, it's bigger.
Yeah. Oh,
and eventually he goes, he's hearing it, and he eventually opens the door to his bedroom. He's like a giant, it's like the size of like a greyhound or something. It's like not the best special effect.
Yeah,
but it really gets your attention.
It's like
though.
Someone took some luggage that's on a roller.
But it's kind of effective because it's so startling. You know?
Yeah.
And it's kind of cool because like he kind of meets like a gruesome end.
And then by the end, you know,
he's begging
the woman who he spurned
to
help him.
Out. Yeah.
And she's like, nah, I won't have any of it.
That's a pretty good one.
That's a good one. Should we do a final round here?
This has been so fun. We've got so many other lists of giant.
Yeah, we could keep going.
We could go on and on. But why don't we do a lightning round?
Mike, you got another one?
We said the Fly earlier. I mean, that's one of my favorites.
The
I mean,
Fly.
That counts,
two
right?
Classics.
Yeah. I say all versions, really.
All versions.
Yeah, I mean, the second of the newer ones.
Well, even the Fly 2 has some stuff. I mean, if you like
right.
Gore, I mean, the Fly 2 is actually...
Because it's directed by an effects artist, Chris totally. Wales, I think, right?
Absolutely, yeah, Chris Wales. Exactly.
I just, it's for me, not as strong of a story.
Well,
no,
the Fly is amazing. Cronenberg
is incredible.
And then by Frank Darabont, the Fly 2.
Oh, okay.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
But we're talking about The Fly from 1958. This is directed by Kurt Newman, who actually did Rocket Ship XM and Kronos.
Love Kronos.
And this is with both Vincent Price and David Hedison.
Yeah.
Who's a guy who's trying to do this teleportation thing and through the accident becomes...
Merges with the Fly.
Merges with the
and
Fly.
And becomes half Fly, half man.
But all horror.
Not all horror.
But I think the thing I love about the 1986 Cronenberg, it's like they really up the ante as far as...
Oh, my God.
As,
yeah.
I mean,
such a good movie.
Talk about, for listeners who haven't seen it, the evolution of Jeff Goldblum turning into
Kafka
an entire
he takes to it,
is unbelievable.
That's one of the best body horror films.
And
it really is.
I still think it holds up for 1986.
Oh, 100%.
It holds up great. It's 100%. A great movie.
And terrific actors between Gina Davis and Jeff Goldblum. They're just fantastic.
You could not have cast that film better.
No,
I really do.
And
dude,
it's one of the very few Cronenberg films with actual like emotional resonance. It's like it's a love story and a tragedy, and you walk away really feeling that. Whereas Cronenberg is usually a lot more clinical.
Yeah, that's true.
Yes,
that's true.
Yeah.
Very much
like,
so.
Like Rabbit is not known for its love story.
Videodrome is not either. Yeah.
Right.
Oh, that's our Valentine's Day movie.
Right.
Mike, those are good ones. James, you got one for us?
I just want to backtrack a little bit to James and the Giant Peach, which I would single out for its songs by Randy Newman. And as you guys know, I'm a huge Randy Newman fan.
Okay.
And Randy Newman is known for being a huge fan of big bucks.
But what he does with these songs is he does them in a style of a kind of English music hall, like an old English music hall style, which is not the type of idiom that he usually works in. And he can do no wrong by me, and I love that score. So,
okay.
There you go.
Well, that's good. Okay, well, I'm just going to throw out two really quickly. Talking from one of the classic animated Disney films, Alice in Wonderland from 1951, we have the Caterpillar. Remember the Caterpillar is a giant. He's a giant.
Oh, yeah, it's true.
And
right.
just really quickly, the voice of him was done by Richard Hayden, who was actually known for playing Max in The Sound of Music. He has a great voice.
Right.
Now, the weird thing is, I saw the musical, the animated, after I saw a play done at a local school when I was about 5 or 6 years old. And just really quickly, it really, really disturbed me because in this play, when it came time for the caterpillar scene, when you first meet the caterpillar, he's sitting on a giant mushroom and he's smoking. Well, the guy that they got to play the caterpillar was known in my neighborhood as kind of the druggy guy.
So perfect casting.
And he was up there, and they had this weird, like almost, I want to say Beatles type
psychedelic
music playing with these flickering lights. And he was wearing a tie-dyed t-shirt and these glasses. And he was really smoking it was like some giant Indian bong or something. As a kid, I'm looking at it going, Is he supposed to be doing that? And he just seemed like he was messed up. And it totally bugged me. Maybe that's why I never got into drugs or something. Because it really,
all
really
because
bugged
of
me.
That.
I can make all that go away.
Okay, but just really, really quickly. So Alison, the last thing is from Lord of the Rings, Return of the King from 2003.
Oh, yeah, that's a great one.
And,
that's a good one.
And we had Jackie Cation, who's a fantastic guest. Her podcast is The Dork Forest. She actually talked in our Fiendish Females episode, Shelob.
Shelob.
And who is the giant spider in Lord of the Rings. And I have to tell you, as far as furry spiders go,
that's
to me,
a scary scene.
That is the
that's
best one.
That is really scary.
Because
scary.
Not only, so when Frodo is going through, he's trying to get to Mordor, and he's going alone, and he gets trapped by the spider. The way the spider gets him and puts him in a web is scary.
Yeah.
But when Sam comes to rescue him, there's this fight sequence where Sam is fighting with his little dagger and this little light thing, and the spider's butt has the dagger stinger
right,
in its butt, and it's moving around trying to sting Sam, and the lair that it's in is really because
that's something too
that
about the way where it's hidden away in a dark.
It's like the Harry Potter movie.
Yes. It has a bunch
that's
of
Harry Potter. That's the one called Harry Potter and the Big Ass Spider.
That's it. That's the one. Yeah.
But Aragog is the name of the spider. See, this we could go on and on.
Who's the character Robbie Coltrane plays?
Hagrid.
Yeah. And he walks into a cave. cave. Well, I remember seeing him one of those movies where he walks into a cave, Aragog, and there's all these spiders.
Well, see, Aragog was his pet back when he first went to Hogwarts, and Hogwarts had and this we're gonna save a lot of this for a Harry Potter episode, but it's a giant spider that he eats the animals around, and he actually has some information that he shares with Harry and Ron, and he promises not to eat Harry and Ron, but he says, "But my children." They're on their own, and that's when they're kind of like attacked by the little all the little spiders. And we'll talk more.
That's a terrible parent.
Yeah. No. But I just want to get back. Lord of the Rings. It's probably one of the best spider sequences. I think.
I think it's great.
No,
I love
it's really
it.
Good.
Yeah. Sean.
All right. I have just a couple real quick here. I want to mention this is not a great movie, but it's interesting to me because, as far as I know, it's the only British produced 50s big bug movie, and that's a movie with Forrest Tucker called The Strange World of Planet X. And it's like Forrest Tucker is a scientist who's experimenting with like the ozone layer or
Doesn't
something.
Does it have another name? Kind
of, yes, it's also known as the Cosmic Monsters.
Okay, that's okay. How
and
I think
it. That's it's what like I'm... it causes something in the, it opens up something in the atmosphere, so it causes all the insect life to mutate and grow in the nearby forest. Not a great movie, but I just, again, interesting because it was right at the height of all the big bug movies.
That's fun. I like that one.
Yeah, and it's the only British one I know that were big bugs. I have to mention, as far as giant bees, this was a hallucination in The Swarm.
Right.
Yeah. And The Swarm was like regular killer bees, but this one kid who like watched his parents get attacked, you know, killed by the bees, he's like in the hospital, Michael Caine, who's an entomologist, he's like, "What happened?" You know, and the kid's like, he's like hallucinating. He's imagining a giant bee in front of him. It's kind of a terrible
effect.
That's
the most memorable scene in that movie.
Pretty much, yeah. The Lost Continent, a Hammer film.
Oh, yes.
Which has kind of I think it's like a giant mollusk.
Yeah.
And like a scorpion. And these are big, like life-size puppet, kind of awkward looking,
they
but
awkward,
fun.
But they are great.
Yeah.
Like, I really enjoy watching those sequences, even though you can kind of see the glue holding them together.
The wheels practically underneath, but it's still fun. And just real quick, I know that like we usually think of the 50s as like maybe the golden era of giant bug movies, but really, talk about, you know, Mike, about Sci-Fi Channel movies and stuff. If you look at the 2000s, there are tons of giant big bug movies.
Well, I don't remember if Eight-Legged Freaks was...
Eight-Legged Freaks was 2002.
Okay,
no. You had one called Spiders... One called, and a lot of these I haven't seen, but these
I've seen spiders.
Arachnia, Mega Scorpion, Centipede, Ice Spiders, Dragon Wasps, one of my favorite, Jai Ants.
Oh, that's good. I didn't see that.
And Arachnoquake.
Wow.
Sadly, I've seen a few of those.
So this is along with Big Ass Spider and along with Lavalantula. So there's been a lot this decade, actually.
Thanks to the Asylum and Sci-Fi CGI, channels.
There's been a lot.
Piranaconda and all those kind of things. Totally.
And let's also remind our listeners that Eight-Legged Freaks featured a friend of the show, Rick Overton.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right.
That's right.
Well, I would like to comment on a few of the... We have some... toys and things that are on the table here.
Totally.
And one that we haven't really discussed is the Xanti Misfits.
The Xanti Misfits.
Which are bugs. They are insects, alien insects.
They're larger than your standard ant.
Yeah.
The Outer Limits.
Yeah, I would say they're about the size of a decent crab, maybe.
Yeah, but are they... Bugs are they're aliens with kind of humanoid heads.
Oh, so dude,
they have humanoid heads, but they're definitely bugs.
They're clearly a bug.
But they're intelligent bugs that can make spaceships and
much like the Metaluna mutant, larger than your standard insect, of course.
Yeah, how's it say? It's larger, of course, higher degree of intelligence.
There we go.
Okay,
but that's how I
But, they're aliens that look like ants, pretty much. And in that episode. The Xantis send their criminals to our planet because
we have an agreement with
an agreement,
right?
And we don't want any trouble with them, so we're just going to take them. We're going to put them in a little area of the desert.
Yes, right.
But then Bruce Dern ruins everything.
Ruins everything as he always does.
It's like we're going to put them in the desert. That's going to be like their prison, their little prison, and they're in their spaceship.
Yeah.
And Bruce Dern. What the heck?
Ruins everything.
It's like, what is this spaceship? What is this thing?
Them all riled up. They end up wreaking havoc on everything.
And Sideshow Toys made two terrific figures.
Probably better than even the original props were at the time. Really.
I think you might have something there. Yeah.
They probably spent more money on them.
Yes, they're great.
And if I remember correctly, one of our other guests, David Scow, actually helped... talk to them about the color and the, exactly the size and shape of these.
Right. He would know.
He would know. He is the Outer Limits expert. Yeah. Yeah. And these are absolutely beautiful figures, and they're really hard to find now. They're kind of scarce.
I know. Yeah, they are.
And I would regret not getting these, and I didn't even know that they made two different kinds. I knew that they made one.
Yeah, one is the Regent, and the other is the Prisoner.
Well, they both came in the same package, though.
Right, right.
Oh, no, mine were separate.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah, mine were separate, too.
Mine
yeah.
were together, too, though.
Mine were together.
I bought them together.
No way.
Yeah, they sold them as a set.
I wonder if that's more valuable.
Maybe.
Maybe. Yeah. Go figure.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, another one I'd like to bring up, and this would also be an alien insect, and that would be Gamera 2, Attack of Legion.
Hmm.
Okay.
And oh, yeah.
Legion is the giant queen of these insect invaders of Earth. But my favorite thing in the film is Legion's dog-sized ant soldiers. And at one point, there's just thousands of them.
Right.
And you see them just like covering a building. And it's a really...
In Shibuya, I
think. Yeah, and it's a great effective shot.
And it's one of those creatures that can multiply into thousands, and then it all combines into one huge
creature. And huge creature I don't like as much as the individual parts.
Yeah,
right.
I agree.
But as Gamera movies go, it's good fun.
Oh, yeah. That whole 90s Gamera trilogy is
so
awesome.
Good.
Yeah,
yes.
Very good.
Cinema is filled with so many awesome big busts.
Yeah. Mm. But I have one more. One final one, and that is there was an episode of Doctor Who called The Runaway Bride.
Oh, yes.
And this is an episode that solidified Catherine Tate as Donna Noble,
right,
who was a companion of David Tennant's Doctor.
All right, I'll take your word for that.
Yes. And hats off goes to Sarah Parrish, who is the Empress of Rachnos. She is basically, again, alien insects, and she is the queen.
Uh-huh.
And imagine this really hot-looking lady top, and the rest of her is just this giant spider. We have her right here.
Oh, is that what this is?
That's what this is.
I was wondering what this was. Oh, listeners,
yes.
There's a beautiful figure on the table.
Beautiful figure that they did.
I had no idea. This is from Doctor Who?
This is from Doctor Who, and that's why you should watch Doctor Who.
There's monsters and stuff in
it. There's cool monsters.
I have to tell you, I'm kind of blown away because this looks absolutely amazing.
And this is a really great episode, too, of a really nice combination of horror and comedy.
Yes, it's true. Yeah, it's good.
But the Empress of Rachnos.
Well, Matt, perhaps I will have to check out that Doctor Who episode.
Do so.
Well, this has been so much fun. I mean, Mike, thank you so much for coming, man.
Thanks for having me. What a blast. This is great.
Yeah, you're totally one of us.
This has been a big-ass fun show.
So, Mr. Bug Creator, I got to ask, do you have anything going on? It's like, what do you work? Is there something we can look forward to?
There's a couple things. There's a show that I'm working on with Matt. I don't know if I can say what it is, but it's a horror comedy television show that I'm a writer on.
Completely unrelated. Mike and I met through another person who is a friend of the show named Dana Gould.
Dana Gould, yes.
Who works on a show called Stand Against Evil.
Stand Against Evil. That was greenlit for its third season.
Absolutely.
Yes, awesome. That's what we hear.
And
right, Mike?
Exactly, yes. And I met Dana through making a film called Tales of Halloween, which is an anthology film.
Really great.
And Dana was kind enough to be in one of those. And we kind of hit it off from there and just love the guy. I'm also part of a movie, not directing. This one I kind of like, because I do all sorts of things. I produce, I edit, I write, I do all sorts of stuff. So this one, I edited a very cool movie that's coming out called Nightmare Cinema, which is also an anthology film. That one's Joe Dante, Mick Garris, David Slade, Yuhei Kitamura, Alejandro Bruges. That's kind of an international sort of masters of horror kind of thing. And that was just a lot of fun to to work with those folks. So So.
And the one thing I want to ask, if listeners, how can they check out Big Ass Spider?
Well, I'll give you a little laundry list of things you can find. You can find on Amazon Prime, you can find Big Ass Spider, and my second film, The Convent, is now streaming on Amazon Prime. On Netflix, you can find Tales of Halloween, and my latest film, Don't Kill It, with Dolph Lundgren, is also on there as well. And also, you can find me on Trailers from Hell, which is a fun thing that I do that a lot of filmmakers do, is they talk about like B movies. I do the B movies. I talk about movies like Meet the Feebles, Pieces.
Yes. Awesome.
What else do I do? A lot of the Peter Jackson ones, Dead Alive. So that's a fun thing. And you can find that on YouTube or on the website Trailers from Hell.
Sounds great.
And you can always follow my adventures on Instagram at Madman Mendez.
I enjoy your adventures.
Thank you. Tonight's Instagram was all about coming here.
Awesome.
It's all about that fear of like, I don't know where I'm going. They could have like machetes and clubs on the other side
which
of that
we
door.
Do.
Oh, yeah. Come on.
Yeah.
Come on.
You never know. I go to a lot of like just people's houses that like they just write me on Facebook, hey, come here, and you never know. So,
that's why it's hard sometimes to get these stars who have no idea what they're getting into.
But when they learn that we treat people right.
Well,
we give people food.
Then I heard there was cocktails. Then I heard there was tacos and beer, and I'm like, I'm in.
That's right. What Denise Crosby said. You just offer an actor a meal, they're there.
Machetes and clubs be damned. I don't care. There's tacos. So
that's why there's hope for us to get Harrison Ford.
There you go.
I think I might have
He's
something
on our list.
That he'll enjoy.
Some good weed. I think that'll do it, you know.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much, Mike.
Yeah,
thanks.
Thanks for coming. Please come again. Like I said, you're one of the family.
And is this where you guys now do what do you guys do after this? Do you guys like jam?
Oh, just a lot of massages.
Do a rap battle. I mean, what
trust
goes
falls.
On?
Thanks again, Mike.
All right,
thanks
thank
for
you.
Being with us.
All right, absolutely.
Time for a listener shout out. This comes from Stephen Batzer.
All right, Stephen.
Stephen Batzer.
Fife Lake, Michigan.
Ooh, cool. Ooh, that's good land.
Stephen is an engineer. And
he engineers stuff.
He writes, greetings, everyone. Welcome to an edition of Monster Party.
Do it right.
Greetings.
Greetings.
Okay. Right. It sounded a little Nazi, but that's fine. Go ahead. Dude, go back to the normal
Hogan?
Way.
No, come on. Don't do that.
Welcome to an edition of Monster Party Appreciation.
Wow. Yay.
Great work on your podcast. Ooh. As a monster kid born in 1963, ooh, who faithfully watched WKBD of Detroit, which had chiller movies at 3:30 p.m. on Saturday.
That's right. He is one of us.
I am glad for what you guys do. Keep it up.
Oh, thank you.
I'm a forensic engineer by trade, and when I watch movies, I pick up on the physics errors probably more than most people. If I could suggest a show topic, it would be science versus science fiction.
Ooh, that's good.
Hey, that's
good.
I like that one. Topic.
You would discuss aspects that aren't physically correct in movies and give counterexamples of movies which did get that science correct.
See, but I get everything wrong. I need like a real scientist guy.
Well, you're not going to be our expert.
Why is it go? You're the go-to scientist guy?
Yeah, wow.
I mean, I'm the guy
Who do I know is a scientist? Larry, of course.
He says, if you need an official science advisor to the show, I'm available.
All right. So, come on out to California, buddy.
Again, thanks for what you do, and make America strong. Watch more monster movies. Steven also sent us some very kind and thoughtful gifts, some books, a DVD, CD.
Awesome, so cool.
Yeah, great stuff.
Thank you so much. Monsters.
Thank you so much, Steven. Glad
That's
you
really
enjoyed
cool.
the show.
Awesome. All right, well, I have another shout out too. This is from a longtime listener and fan named Zach Cato. From Lexington, Kentucky. And Zach writes,
I did stand up there.
Really? Okay. Yeah. Zach writes, dearest Monster Men, I am running to express my gratitude and support for all things Monster Party. It occurs to me that I once lived without horror obscura and psychopaths and kaiju and Larry's love for vintage boxed air. But as famed Hollywood producer Mike Flange says, that's showbiz, asshole.
My God, this is genius.
So, anyway, I recently came across a vintage Monster Party NES game.
What?
This was a game I remember. Like, if you search Monster Party, sometimes you come across this game, like from I think the 90s. Or 80s or 90s.
No.
It's like a Monster Party game. And he says, well, I know you guys aren't gamers. I picked it up as a display piece and token of gratitude.
Oh, that's great.
Really cool. I play pinball.
The game really...
Parcheesi?
The cover of the box is really cool. It's like Medusa on it and a creature-like thing. Audrey from Little Shop of Horrors. It's a cool...
And you can play this, right?
Yeah, my wife, we have a Nintendo game thing, so we should be able to play it. So
your next
it.
Party, we should play it.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
All right.
Strip.
And Zach also, he says, I stashed a couple more things in the box, which may not connect with you, but which were big pieces of my childhood that elicit fond memories. Isn't that what Monster Party is all about? And actually, what he did connect with us. He gave us some Bendham's monsters.
From Just Toys. I know these figures. 90s. And the funny thing is, I just want to tell you, buddy, thank you for sending these to us, because unfortunately, I have these too. But I took them off the package, like an idiot.
So these are still mint,
I want to tell you, buddy.
And here's me opening mine.
I'm going to keep mine sealed in its package.
Yeah, that was just Foley.
The air in here is from 1991, and I'm going to save that.
Yeah, so we have Frankenstein, Dracula, the Mummy, and the Wolfman. Thanks so much.
Why didn't they make a creature?
Pass them out.
It's like so stupid. Yeah. They should have made a creature.
I know.
So Zach finishes it by saying, thanks again for everything. I'll never watch Interiors.
Oh!
in Godzilla we trust, Zach Cato. Thanks so much, Zach. Really, thank you.
That's
awesome.
That's amazing.
I want all these guests on our show now.
I know. Yeah. Yes, so nice.
And, you know, just because you love Monster Party as a listener, we do not mean to intimate that you should send us DVDs.
But you definitely should.
Toys. Don't, really.
We don't have enough stuff.
We're not suggesting that you send any of those things, so please.
No, it's always appreciated, though.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Still sealed
so awesome.
In the package. Yeah. Can you believe that?
Do you guys have any vintage gift certificates?
Exactly.
Vintage meaning a week or two.
Zach made little magnets too of the Monster Party game as magnets for us
too,
which is awesome.
Really great.
So yes, thank you.
Yes, thanks, Zach.
Thanks so much.
Well, I've got a shout out, and this one is kind of a special one because it's a longtime listener who has been unwell for a while. He hasn't been feeling too great, and he reached out to us on Facebook, and it's Tobias Sternstrom.
Tobias,
we love you, Tobias. One of our loyal listeners.
Hey, Tobias.
And he's been feeling under the weather. And so I think we should all give him a get better
Monster Party
get
hug.
Get stronger.
Yes.
Get more monstrous.
Yes.
Get better, Tobias.
And come to America. We'll show you a good time.
Yeah.
Totally.
Because we know how to have a good time, right? Action figures, booze, loneliness. It's all there. All the boxes are checked.
And Tobias has gotten his nephew into Monster Party,
yes,
too.
Yes, that's right.
He's getting the younger generation. He is passing it on.
Yeah. And he sent us a great picture
of
him and his nephew, and they're both wearing matching alien hoodies.
Yes. Oh, that is so cool.
Look at that, huh?
Which we will post.
Yeah.
Thanks, Tobias.
Really
hey, man.
Great.
Get well soon,
feel
buddy.
Better, my friend.
Feel better.
Yes.
And then I would also like to give a shout out to a fan of a game that I did years ago when I was working with Presto Studios, and these are the guys that did like the Journeyman Project, Buried in Time, and we did a game called Whacked.
Whacked.
It was kind of
wacky.
It was kind of based on the Seven Deadly Sins, and it was a really fun game to write.
Like the movie Seven?
No. Although that would be fun.
That sounds horrifying.
You just keep finding heads in boxes, and they give you energy. I like it. Let's work on this. Right. Let's pitch it. But Jill Nesbitt is a big fan of Whacked. And so she contacted me through my manager and then got a hold of me on Facebook, and we've been chatting, and she's
awesome.
Just lovely and great. And
is she listening to Monster Party?
Yes, she is. She's been listening to our shows, and she enjoys them.
Thanks, Jill.
Yeah, and she's terrific. So shout out to Jill Nesbitt.
Thanks, Jill.
Now, I need to bring up something right now.
Uh-oh.
And this is a hypothetical, and I want our fans to weigh in if they would be interested in this type of scheme. So Monster Party started off as a sweaty YouTube show, then moved on to a mega successful podcast.
Oh, yeah.
And we want to kind of see where we can take this thing. So we had some ideas of things to do, kind of live events. And so I would just like to kind of take a poll of our audience, contact us on Facebook or wherever, and let us know if you would be up to, first idea, we thought it might be kind of fun to do a Japan trip where we got a bunch of listeners and we worked out some sort of travel package where we took some of our listeners, we went with them to Japan, and we gave them the ultimate nerd kaiju, tokusatsu, anime
experience. Because we've been there a bunch of times.
We've been there a bunch of times.
We know where to go.
We know where to go.
We know the places.
We know the stores. We know the toy stores. We know the restaurants.
Nerd monster fan tour.
Yeah. We know...
theme restaurants.
Theme restaurants and sites. And there's just all kinds of things that we could take you to that any nerd would really enjoy.
Shops.
Shops. And who knows? By the time we put this all together, maybe we could even throw in some extra special events. And of course, you would also be part of our podcast that we would do.
Yeah.
So that's one idea. The other idea would be a cruise.
A cruise?
Yeah. Doing
a monster party cruise?
A monster party cruise.
Yep.
We were talking with a fan of ours and who's also just a really great guy, Pasher.
Pasher House. He's an amazing body paint artist.
Incredible artist. And he is going to be doing some work with us soon, which I will address later. But he was talking to us about maybe doing a cruise because he did a cruise. And the logistics of it were easier than we ever would have thought of. Mm-hmm. And so if you guys would be interested in doing a cruise where, once again, we'd do the cruise, we would have events, we would do a podcast.
Would show, sea and ocean-themed horror films.
Maybe I'd bring my 16-millimeter projector, we'd show crazy shorts, and it would be a good time. So that's another idea. And then the other one, which is similar in theme, which would be just a live event. We go to some city, maybe it's ours, maybe it's out of the Bay Area or wherever, and we rent a movie theater, we show some movies, we maybe give audio commentary.
Right.
Maybe we do a raffle or something. Yeah. We do a raffle. We would make it a fun kind of mini convention.
A mini convention.
Party.
And a monster party mini convention.
And I think that would be a whole bunch of fun.
Oh, yeah.
But contact us. Let us know if any of these ideas fly your kite.
Yeah.
As the kids are saying these days.
Kids.
And speaking of Pasher, we are also going to be appearing at the upcoming Monsterpalooza convention.
Monsterpalooza!
Monsterpalooza!
And not just as attendees this time.
No, we have a table.
That's right.
We can have a monster party table.
We have we're going to have a table. We're going to have guests. Anybody we can pull over to do what is going to be kind of an ongoing recording of a podcast throughout the day.
Yeah.
And we're also going to have some guests. We're going to have Pasher's going to come with a model, and he's going to be doing body painting on her.
So not us.
No.
I just want to be clear.
No money we offered him was enough to do that.
Because I actually have like a little Speedo that I'm... I was preparing to wear.
Wow. This is horror right now.
What he would do is he would paint a Speedo on you.
Yeah.
Like, wow, that's a lumpy Speedo.
Well, it's, kind of pudgy now.
So. Well, I know what you speak, but...
But if there's ever been a reason to come to Monsterpalooza... This is it. No matter where you are in the world, fly to Pasadena. You can meet us.
It's a great convention.
It's fantastic.
We're going to have merchandise. We're going to have t-shirts.
And I will not be in Speedo.
I can't guarantee that won't happen because I may put something in your drink. But,
but it's a great convention. It's getting bigger every year. And especially the main one in Pasadena in April is going to be huge. There's all kinds
of
guests
to
there,
do.
And we'll be there. So, like,
and if you're planning to attend anyway, make sure you find us and say hi and we'll interview you.
Totally.
And Matt, I want to add, we're also going to have on Sunday a fabulous special guest in our booth.
That's right.
That's right. Playmate of the Year from 2013, Raquel Pomplin.
Friend of the show.
Big fan of the show.
Really good
friend of the
show,
actually. We had her as a guest. Yeah, and she loves us. We love her.
And what's great about Raquel is not only is she fun and exciting, and she's, you know, she does these little things on YouTube called Chocolate Milk, which are fun to watch.
They are. They're really fun.
But the other cool thing is she did a bunch of like superhero or monster pictures that she posed for, and I think she's going to have them for sale.
Yeah. She's going to be selling autographs.
So. She's a delight.
Awesome. And beautiful.
We're so honored to have her.
So look, if you don't want to meet the Monster Party guys, you've got to come by to meet Climate of the Year from 2013, Raquel Pomplin. Yeah,
so this is going to be a good
time.
It's going
to be happening.
And we look forward to meeting anyone who shows up. We'll be at table wherever in the X lounge. Yeah, oh yeah, West Wing of wherever it is. In the
yeah, place. Just look where look for where the huge crowd is.
Yeah,
that's where we're gonna be.
Yeah. Where you can smell the sex appeal coming from.
Yes.
That'll
oh,
be
yeah.
that'll be us.
I believe. I think we're gonna be in the Phantom section.
Yeah, called the Phantom Zone.
Phantom Zone. Really.
We'll be in the boiler room.
No. We're kind of behind a theater, which is kind of cool. So
yeah, this will be fine.
But anyway,
no, it's gonna be exciting.
No, it's gonna be fun.
And it's all happening April 13th through the 15th at the Pasadena Convention Center. Go to monsterpalooza.com for tickets and details.
But hey, I want to give a special thank you and shout out to our sponsors at Creature Features.
Yay! Yay!
Creature Features, located at 2904 West Magnolia Boulevard in beautiful downtown Burbank. Taylor, Eric, and Matt, they have a fantastic selection of stuff which will fulfill all your monster needs. They have models, CDs.
They have big bug stuff.
They do. And they also have these great art shows. They also have speakers come in and talk. I want to suggest you check out Creature Features. Check out their website. It lists all the information they have. You also can check them out on their eBay store at C-Features. They offer a lot of great stuff that they also sell in the store. I also want to give a special thanks to Time Tunnel Toys.
Yay!
Time Tunnel Toys, located at 1583 Meridian Avenue in San Jose, California. Joe and Sharon, they have an amazing store filled with all kinds of vintage toys, magazines, records, kitschy stuff. Black velvet paintings, Star Wars figures, Stife toys. They have so much great stuff. And every 4 months, they put together this amazing toy convention called the San Jose Super Toy Collectible Show. Go to their website, Time Tunnel Toys, San Jose, California. Check out all the information. Great place.
Cool.
Lovely. Yeah.
Let's remind our listeners, you can find us on Facebook and YouTube at Monster Party TV. Our Twitter handle is at Monster Party HQ. Also on Instagram, we're Monster Party HQ. If you're listening to us on iTunes, please take a moment and write a review. We would love to hear from you. The Monster Party cap is available for sale at our eBay store, which is called Monster Party Store.
High quality cap.
And newsflash, in the near future, we will, as Matt mentioned, also be selling, making available the Monster Party t-shirt.
It's t-shirt!
A
couple different versions, too.
Yeah, and it's not up yet, but we will let you know when it is.
So stay tuned.
Yeah. Exciting, isn't it? Well, I guess that's the end of our show. And oh. Oh, my. Hey, I'm starting to feel a little funky.
Are you feeling funky?
Oh, word.
I think we need to do some rapping here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Because I like big bugs and I cannot lie. David Hedison played the fly. He got caught in a web. Vincent Price says he's dead. It's horrifying. You can't deny. Huge insects and starship troopers. Verhoeven's bug masterpiece poopers. Violent bugs in space. Good marines all over the place. It's what I call super duper. The film them has big fat ants. They're too huge to fit in your pants. They destroy a city, but they still look pretty. And they put little kids in a trance. Large tarantulas covered in hair. Giant ants that make you stare. Massive roaches and spiders. Scorpions and sliders. I love big bugs, so beware. I say James and Matt and Sean all know what turned me on.
Yes.
Films with a large, big-ass bug or a gross, slimy slug. I'll watch movies like that till dawn. So, get ready. So for the next meeting, don't be tardy. You've got guests who are rather hardy. We'll discuss and fight all through the night. So listen into Monster Party.
Yeah!
I just want to say thank you so much for listening to my Monster Big Bug rap. It's music by Sir Mix-a-Lot. He's got Baby Got Back. And I've been drinking. And, you know, I've been working on this for weeks. And I hope you guys like my Monster Big Bug rap.
Oh, I will never be the same. On that note, I am Matt Weinhold.
I'm Sean Sheridan.
I'm rapping Larry Strode.
And I'm James Gonis.
Keep America rapping strong.
Watch big bug movies. Why? Because
I like big bugs and I cannot lie. David has played the fly. Got caught in a web. Price is dead. It's horrifying. You can't deny.
Fade out.
What's happening now?
And I've got fun.
All right, well then let's go.
Some you have fun? Memories. Now you're yelling.
I'm not
Sean.
Yelling.
No, Sean is.
I am.
Sean, yeah, all of a sudden he's...
You know, so, can I get my headphones on, maybe?
Yes, you may.
God. You know, I'm trying to help set up.
Okay, but while you're saying that, you better put your headphones this? On.
Hello, hello. Testing, testing. Sounds good.
And are we wearing the bug masks?
I'm going to. Okay. You don't have to.
We're not now.
I'm game.
You've got glasses.
Yeah,
you know.
That's true.
Yeah, I might need my regular glasses to see from time to time.
And so, Mike, just to let you know, I'll be taking photos throughout.
Okay, sure.
Nude photos.
Yeah.
Yeah. Candids.
So what we'll do is it'll be tasteful at first.
Right. We'll at first.
Yeah.
But after the third or fourth beer.
Yeah.
And the Bill Cosby little...
Yeah. We call... We call them monster smarties.
Hey, Mike, do you like rap music? Do you like getting down?
I do.
Oh, boy, you're in for real treat.
Do you like gladiator movies?
Well, I don't know if
do
I have...
Do you like movie. Rap music? Yeah. Do you like getting down?
Well, no, man, I've got a wow. treat. I've got a special treat.
Welcome to the whitest show
no, listen,
in existence.
Listen, when you hear what I've got, for you are going to be blown away.
I'm
blown away. You are going to go.
I can't wait.
You're going to look at me and go.
I'm going to go. Damn.
You.
Yeah.
You're going to say you are the.
What you talking about, Willis? That's what I'm saying.
No. Let's not.
Dynamite.
Go there. No. That's blatant. Come on. I'm just. No. I'm hip. You know.
That is the word that always comes to mind when I think of Larry.
Yeah.
The hippest guy.
Which one of us is a hip cat? Well, that would be Larry.
Yeah, that's
that'd be Larry Stroh.
You're like a Larry Stroh. You're a hip cat, man.
No, hip cat.
Hip cat? Hip cat. Yeah.
No, and we are recording this. Sometimes what we do is we take the very beginning and we throw it on the end as a little...
Because it's only good enough to be at the very end.
Yeah, because if you could get through our entire show,
yes.
then
you deserve
three more minutes isn't going to harm you.
Okay.
All right, the glasses are great.
Yeah.
Man.
Cool. Hey.
I love it. I love it.
Do you know, I really do love those glasses. Do you know how long I've had these, by the way?
Since birth.
No, but I've... And get this. No. You may think this is funny.
I think that's the idea,
right? No.
Check this out.
Check this out.
You're not wearing that for drama.
I've had these glasses for literally 20 years.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
And I've been waiting. I've been waiting for the special moment
to bring
these out. And I've been, you know, when we started to do Monster Party, but no, just bear with
you
me.
Kept thinking, when we're gonna do the show,
and you're like,
he's hit the wall. It's not gonna get any weirder than this. Now you pull out the fact that you have like an Imelda Marcos closet of glasses for every possible occasion.
No, just for this big bugs. And so, Matt, I've been waiting, I've had these put aside for years ever since we started to do Monster Party, and I have two pairs.
But they're both out of the package.
That's true.
Well, yes.
good night, everybody.
That's good.
All right, let's start this damn thing.
Can I just say one thing?
Please.
If you guys listen very... Can you hear that little twitch?
I hear the little bugs.
Right. Yeah, right. Hold on. Right. Thank you.
It's an insect.
It's bug-themed. That's the thing.
Sounds like crickets.
Like crickets, exactly.
Like robot crickets. I think it was your phone.
It's your goddamn phone.
No,
get away. No.
Hey. I think I changed. I fixed it.
It's radioactive.
Yeah, I think you fixed it. I don't think
well,
it.
Well, hey, you know what?
Okay. Let's leave the phone on that sign.
Okay.
Hey, there's a little anger. I noticed this.
No, there's no anger.
It's not only that, but it's quick to anger and then immediately to blame.
You know what?
That's how it works.
It's passion.
Is it? No. Okay.
And it's because I care.
All right.
Yeah.
I care. You having a good time?
It's all love, man. God damn it, are you having a good time? Fuck.
Where are you on the I want to leave meter?
No, he's dying to be here. Okay, let's do this.
I'm blocked in for whatever it's worth.
Moment of silence.
Okay, all right, here we go. Well, I guess that's it for our show, but wait a minute. Oh, my. I'm starting to feel strangely funky.
Yeah. You're going to get down, buddy. Ooh. You're going to get down because I'm feeling buggy.
Word.
I'm feeling big.
Word up. Yeah.
I like big bugs and I cannot lie. David Hedison played the fly. He got caught in a web that suppresses his dead. It's horrifying, you can't deny. Huge insects in Starship Troopers. Verhoeven's big mess piece poopers. Violent bugs in space, got marines overplaced. It's what I call super duper. The film them as big fat ants. They're too huge to fit in your pants. They destroy a city, but they still look pretty, and they put little kids in a trance. Watch tarantulas covered in hair. Giant ants that make you stare. Massive roaches and spiders. Scorpions and sliders. I love big bugs, so beware. I say James and Matt and Sean all know what turned me on. Films with a big bass bug or a gross slimy slug. I'll watch movies like that till dawn. So, listen, all my friends. So, for the next big meeting, don't be tardy. We've got guests on Monster... shit. I fucked up. I gotta do it again.
That's all right.
It's my last line.
It's funny. I'm sorry. Go again. I thought you were also a little off on the
I was off.
Do you know when to start on this? When do you start singing? You want to hear it again? Before?
I like the mess up.
It was funny.
No, you gotta have.
It'll be a blooper anyway.
You gotta have me finish that. It's the last line.
No, I want him to do it. I want him to do it the way he wants it to be done. Yeah.
The whole thing again.
Yeah.
Have him. Did you guys like it so far?
I love it. It's great.
I say James and Matt and Sean all know what turned me on.
My favorite thing is so.
You know, I was stalling.
Don't include that.
No.
Okay.
You got to do it.
All right.
Ready? Don't put this. This isn't that good.
Huh? Come on.
Don't put the blooper. It's
why? Okay. It's a blooper. It's all funny. Okay. We all laughed. We had a good time.
Okay. Did you like that?
Yeah, that's great. Fantastic. I thought that was awesome.
Did you like that, man?
I loved it. That's good. I loved it.
It's going to go viral.
I'm totally willing to let you know if you thought it was stupid.
No.
Larry, no. I'm like, you know what? I'm fine.
It's done with love.
It is done with love.
It's fantastic.
I included all you guys.
I love it. It's great. I got zero notes, Larry.
Now at the end of every episode.
Yeah, they're going to expect.
Yeah, I'm going to need a. You're going to have to do every style of music. Yeah. Black metal.
Well, it's funny you should say that because. Because, you know, Xanadu, the soundtrack,
I thought you were going to say Xanax for a second. I don't know. It just felt right.
No, because I could do... I
Magic
love,
and Xanadu.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Anyway.
Right, we're going to go to... We are all going to jail.
I hope you guys enjoyed that. It was out of love.
It was terrific. You know,